mean, there's nothing to complain about.
It's still a good season for them.
Here. Of course, but it's the first episode of 1-on-1 for June 2022, and we've got we've got a loaded show.
Dude, it's June.
Today.
That's crazy.
It's June. This year has flown by. We're done with the school year, technically. Some kids are taking summer classes.
Dude, imagine.
Oh, my God. Well, I'm taking one. You know, you got to do what you got to do. But it's the first episode of June, and we've got a loaded show today. We're going to start off the first hour with some Mets talk, some Yankees talk, discussing the state of New York baseball entering June, looking forward for both of the teams. And then heading out of that first hour, we're going to be joined by Miles Grossman, who's going to discuss us a little bit of NBA Finals. He's going to recap Game 1. We're going to talk about looking forward to the rest of the NBA Finals. Great matchup between the Celtics and the Warriors. I mean, two very well-balanced teams. Very even matchup. And then, I mean, after that, we're going to talk to WFUV's very own New York Rangers beat reporter, Colin Lochran.
Dude, tune in for that.
Oh,
Colin Lochran, he brings it. There's no one better in the business.
Colin has the energy. I mean, texting Colin off air after games, the guy is so energetic, so excited to be, like, just be in the arena with MSG, the world's most famous arena, and just seeing the Rangers. I mean, come on. This is magical. And then we're going to talk a little bit of Rangers. We're going to talk a little bit of Stanley Cup playoffs during that segment. Talk some Rangers, Lightning. We're going to talk about the other side of the spectrum with the Oilers and the Avalanche. A little bit more uneven of a series.
Listen, I'm not sure if we're going to have a chance to get into this in the segment, so I'll just say it right now because we're going to talk some hockey. Like, mm-hmm. I'm surprised more people don't like hockey. Like, if you don't like the Stanley Cup playoffs, there's something wrong with you. You just don't have a crucial thing that you need. I mean, the Stanley Cup playoffs, it's awesome. And that's another thing. I don't understand why people don't like hockey, because, like, I was thinking, you know how people complain, like, sports are soft? There's fighting in hockey.
There's fighting?
It's legal. It's basically encouraged.
Oh, yeah.
Whenever there's a break in action, some guy just comes up and shoves a glove in another guy's face like that. How do you not like that?
Look at the game one between the Lightning and the Rangers at the end. It got a little chippy.
Seven guys leave in the third period. Like,
exactly. Between
awesome,
Ryan Reeves
man.
And Pat Maroon. We knew that fight was coming, but it was a little light, a little preview for next couple games. I'm expecting a Revo-Maroon fight soon, though. It was funny seeing Reeves just sitting on top of the rest and sitting on top of the pile just laughing.
He knocked the ref over.
He knocked the ref over just smiling, looking like a Batman villain. That's
my favorite thing that Reeves does is that he doesn't even have to fight sometimes, but he'll just taunt guys and then laugh in their face. They yell at him.
He did it to Tony
D'Angelo. There's not a better power move than that.
He did it to Tony D last series, and we know how Rangers fans feel about Tony D'Angelo, and that was... That might have just swung the series. Just setting the tone of just being like, I'm better than you, I'm bigger than you, I'll beat you up, and you can't do anything about it. That's kind of how the Rangers are. Reeves, Trouba, Lindgren, the Warrior himself. I mean, come on, this team, it's a team of destiny. It's a great feeling to watch this Rangers team make their run into the Stanley Cup playoffs. But then we're going to end that final hour together with another headlining segment with Miles, talking a little WNBA talk, talking about some unfortunate circumstances around the New York Liberty, but looking forward to the rest of the WNBA season. We're going to talk a little bit about that. Really excited to get that segment going. After that, we're going to talk to New York Post's very own Mark Berman, Knicks beat reporter. We're going to talk to him about all things Knicks for a little interview. Thank you again to Mark Berman for joining the show. And then finally, our final segment. It's going to be a fun one. Lou and I took a little bit of inspiration from John Boy Media.
We stole their idea.
But we're giving them credit, obviously. John Boy, great company. But we listened to their Talking Baseball episode with, I mean, John Boy, Jake, Trevor Plouffe. Yep. And they had a episode last Wednesday, I believe, that was just talking about their May All-Star team. We're going to go... So far
we're doing it
season.
A little bit yeah. different because we're doing it through May.
Through May. We're doing the whole season so far.
I don't
far.
Feel bad about stealing their segment because it's not like it's a completely unique idea.
Oh, no,
it's a natural conversation to have. We're in June. It's kind of like the first time you can really – you're through 2 months. People's stats kind of are legit at this point.
Stats kind of matter.
I think All-Star voting starts soon. It usually starts up sometime in June. So it's not the worst conversation to have at this point in time.
Yeah,
I'm excited for it.
We're at the time where we can actually discuss this stuff. I mean, it matters.
It's weird talking about it the first – like, it's weird talking about All-Stars in April because it's like you're through a month. Like, you can have a hot month. Case in point, Anthony Rizzo.
Rizzo, yeah. We would have thought Rizzo was the MVP frontrunner through April. Rizzo's cooled down a little bit, but last two games, I mean, what can you say? Rizzo had the go-ahead RBI against the Angels in the second half of the doubleheader, and then last night hit a home run. I mean, Rizzo might be back.
It was funny because I was with my friend at the Yankee game yesterday, and he was Rizzo's up, and he's talking about, man, we should trade for Josh Bell, and then Rizzo hits a three-run bomb, and I was like, you love a good screw-you bomb like that.
That's good silencer? There's nothing like a good crowd silencer. I will say that. In sports, there's nothing like a good crowd silencer. Going on the road, for example, going on the road and shutting a road crowd up like the Rangers did in Game 7 against the Carolina Hurricanes. And then shutting up fans that, you know, bicker a little bit too much, say some stupid stuff. But, you know,
listen, let's
it's
call
fun.
The Yankee fans are stupid sometimes.
They get a little
they overreact a little bit. And maybe it's their job to bring them back down to earth. Anthony Rizzo is a great ball player.
Yeah, maybe a little reactionary. But what can we say? It's the New York sports fans. We all get a little crazy, but we're all passionate. But you know what? I'm really excited to get into the show today. But we're going to head into a quick little break. And we're going to come back with a little bit of Mets talk with Miles Grossman.
Hey folks, this is Thomas Aiello
with Ryan Gregware,
and we're your main hosts for WFUV Sports' new college basketball podcast, Storm the Court.
We'll talk about the top 25 rankings, some of the big games from the week before, and preview the slates ahead.
We also talk Fordham basketball, both men's and women's, so don't be afraid to listen to that as well.
Tyler Hu and Danny Scott also joined the show as recurring hosts.
So make sure to tune in to Storm the Court, a production of WFUV Sports. This is the road to March.
We'll start off today with the always exciting New York Mets. I mean, they call them the Amazings for a reason. The three of us have a ton to talk about with the Mets this year, as they're finally putting it all together with all of Steve Cohen's spending and making it all happen. It's the Amazings for a reason. They're dominating the NL West, with a 35-18 record.
They're playing a team.
They
in
are
NL
playing
West.
In the West. Speaking of, they are playing in the West,
and
but
it is not so amazing.
It's not so amazing.
So far,
but
through the first two games,
what can you expect? They're playing the best or second best team in baseball, the LA Dodgers. We'll get into that in a second, but I mean, this team continues to exceed even the wildest of expectations. Mets fans always have very high expectations. Always come in sometimes a little delusional, but you know, most of the time they're passionate, and you got to respect that.
I think Mets fans, it's a weird balance of they have high expectations, but they also expect everything to go wrong every year. It's a really unique balance. I think, you know, Yankee fans, you expect to win the World Series every year. I think Mets fans expect to, you know, get off to a crazy start and then watch everything collapse.
The June
flutters. So it's a really weird juxtaposition that you got going on there. But listen, today, if you're a Mets fan listening, you're probably not thrilled to hear us open about how amazing they are, right? They dropped two of the Dodgers, but you have to keep everything in mind. It's been a pretty crazy season, and I think you think back to that Scherzer injury, right? May 18th, gets pulled from the game, and you find out the next day he's going to be out for 6 weeks.
Yeah.
And you got to feel like the sky is falling, right? DeGrom's out now, Scherzer's out.
And Tyler Miguel, too. Another third arm we're going to talk about, too.
How do the Mets respond? Their offense carries them, leads the MLB in batting average before the Dodgers series. They led the NL in weighted runs created plus and OPS, so the offense really responds there, and I think that's the most impressive thing to me is an injury like Scherzer's, when you lose that guy that was your number two, was your number one
for all of this year
because DeGrom's been out, right? To lose that guy, to lose McGill, that can be a devastating blow. For the offense to come and really carry the team and fight back that hard, that's a good sign that this Mets team is maybe going to do things differently this year.
Yeah, and the reason why I'd say the Mets have been so hot in the month of May has really been depth. You look up and down their lineup, you have guys like Guillorme at the bottom.
I can't wait to talk about
Guillorme, exactly. Got to break that down. But also, you know, even guys like McNeil, they go up to bat and you expect them to get on base almost every time, it seems. The reliable hitters, they're guys that are might not be your star, but are just role players with a championship mentality. And that's huge for this Mets team. Is up and down this lineup, it seems like you got guys who are willing just to play their role, do their job day in and day out. And that's a great attitude if you're going to be on the team like the Mets, who really has a chance at making a postseason run. And as you guys touched on already, it's the injuries that have absolutely plagued the Mets pitching staff so far. Scherzer out. And I was at the game just on Tuesday, I believe. It was Tyler McGill a handful of hours before the game on Tuesday against the Nationals. He was out on the bump at Citi Field getting some work in. He's surely going to return to some sort of rehab start in the coming weeks. He was getting his pickoff moved down before he had a couple live ABs against McNeil and some others. So you could tell he was close for sure. So now that you have McNeil, then hopefully in the coming months, Scherzer and possibly DeGrom, things might really all come together at the right time for the New York Mets. With you, when you have a lineup like this, and then you have three pitchers who hopefully will come back before you have time to make a run at a deep playoff run. So I'm excited for the Mets. The Mets are in a position that they really haven't been in past years, where the lineup is deep and you know, the pitching staff really has an opportunity to do something if they're able to stay healthy.
Yeah,
it's a big if.
It's a massive if, but we've seen, look at this. Since Max Scherzer got hurt on May 18th, I believe it was, Lou, you brought that up, the Mets have averaged 6.3 runs per game. That's insane. How insane is that? That's sick. To like bring out that run support,
day in and day out.
It's a very next man up mentality in that clubhouse. Buck Showalter's preaching next man up, hard work, team play, and just, you know, moving the next runner over. They play a good, very fun style of baseball to watch. I mean, they've played some of the games of the year. Thrillers where, for example, let's go back to, I think there was a Mets-Phillies game.
Mets-Phillies, a big comeback.
Where the Phillies did a Phillies thing and then blew a massive lead.
But then the same comeback against the Giants, too. It's the same thing.
That's another one.
You look at both of those comebacks, and it's a real masterclass in just putting the ball in play and watching good things happen. And
two-out rallies.
To have guys like Starling Marte on that team where they can hit a ground ball and beat it out.
Right.
I think that's one of the things Steve Cohen did really well in putting this team together is you look at the depth, you look at all the guys through the lineup, they can all make contact, they can all put the ball in play.
Yeah.
Right now they're second in the entire league in batting average, a point behind the Colorado Rockies, which, you know, go figure, who thought the Rockies were going to be hitting this well?
Coors Field.
And it's early in the year.
It's early in the year. But, like, the Mets, as I said, next man up mentality. Look at a guy like Nick Plummer coming in. Just hitting two home runs at 440. I mean, this is a very small sample size. He has 9 at-bats, but 2 home runs, 4 hits, batting 444. This is 17-22 OPS.
I mean,
like,
stats.
Like, come on. Yeah. Nick Plummer, another guy. We mentioned Guillorme. Just Guillorme's balling out. Everybody's really, like, it feels like everybody's up. They've been great acquisitions during the offseason. Really aggressive spending at the, like, and it's pretty much all worked out, I feel like.
It allows that depth that you're talking about, it allows them to stomach a loss like Dom Smith having to send him down to the minors because he's just not getting it done. You can't send a guy down like that if you don't have depth, and you can't continue to succeed if you don't have depth. Dom Smith a couple of years ago was one of the biggest parts of this Mets lineup where you looked at it and it was, how are we going to get Alonso and Dom in the lineup together? Because these are the two guys we need to have in the lineup. Fast forward a couple of years, and it's been a little bit of a rough stretch for Dom. Right. The Mets are kind of able to stomach it. But the thing I'm a little concerned about is that the pitching since Scherzer's injury hasn't been great. That's where I think you're kind of starting to see a little bit of struggles. Bullpen, I think, in general, has just been an issue. I think Diaz has been
good, but there
are questions about the bullpen depth. And then the rotation ERA since Scherzer's injury, it's 5.24, and that's if you continue to rely on the offense, that's when you get into trouble. Look at this series against the Dodgers so far; we're only two games in.
Yeah,
they've scored one run.
But you go up against one of the best pitching staffs in all of baseball, and the offense disappears. And even though I don't think the pitching's been terrible, it's you're not getting the lights out stuff that you might get if DeGrom or Scherzer is healthy, and that's where you're kind of gonna get into trouble. And this series, it's a reminder that this is the team that's waiting for you in the NLCS. Like,
exactly,
you can have a great regular season. This Dodgers team, this stacked team, best roster in baseball, one of the best pitching staffs statistically in baseball. That's the team that's waiting for you on the other side if you want to get to that World Series.
Exactly. And going into this West Coast swing for the Mets, they were 35-17. Obviously an unbelievable record, more than anything anyone could ever hope or ask for. But it is important to mention who those teams that they played for through those 40-something games that they had an unbelievable record in. You know, they played a lot of games against the lowly Nationals, right. Obviously the Phillies, the Marlins. Exactly. Within that NL East, there's a lot of teams such as the Marlins and the Nationals. They're going to gift you a lot of free games. And they've already eaten up a lot of their free games that they'll get in that NL East throughout the year. So now that you're facing teams like the Dodgers, obviously, you know, and the Angels and the Padres are not,
They're not slouches either.
Especially though the Angels have been struggling, that's still a very talented team that is,
who
they get things
absolutely
rolling,
come alive.
Right.
Exactly.
And the Padres are insane.
So when you have a Mets bullpen like the way they are, that's kind of your weak link. That's really difficult against solid teams on this West Coast swing. So I think it's a really good litmus test for the Mets, right? You've had kind of these cupcake victories through the first, like, third of the season. Now you go to the West Coast and you see, and you really get to test your team. Where are we at without our star pitchers? And even when you have your top three pitchers arguably come back in DeGrom, Scherzer, and McGill, that bullpen's still going to be an issue. You know, so in August, September, if the Mets bullpen isn't fixed up, you know, that could be a serious problem. It might be the kind of issue that Cohen tries to address at the deadline, because if they're really going to make a run deep in the postseason, bullpen's so vital. You know, I'm a big Dodgers fan, and I've seen absolutely get crushed in late season games due to our bullpen just self-destructing. So the Mets need to definitely shore up their bullpen, but that seems to be their weak link. And if they're able to do that, what a team they have.
And one of the things you brought up, right, the schedule, and I think there's two sides to that conversation. The first side is, hey, you can only play who's on your schedule. So if you're playing bad teams, hey, you still got to beat them, and that's what the Mets have done.
Right. But you can't drop to their level. A lot of teams do that.
That's what the Dodgers did this past weekend against the Pirates.
Exactly.
Right. The Yankees did last year against the Orioles. They didn't really, you know, come out hot.
Mm-hmm. But it is one of the things worth noting, right? According to Power Rankings Guru, I looked this up, Mets had the ninth easiest schedule in the MLB through 2 months of play, right? And you come into a June where they might not be looking forward to this month. 17 of their 24 games in June are against opponents with a winning record above 500.
Yeah.
And that's tough, because you're looking at an MLB where it's like 12 teams have a record above 500. It's not a lot of teams. It's a very top-heavy league.
Mm-hmm.
And then the seven games that aren't against 500 teams are divisional opponents. Mm-hmm. Six of them are against the Marlins, who they can pitch. Like they might be going through some rough spots, but between, you know, you got Pablo and Sandy at the top
Sandy's
of that rotation, you can't take any days off. There's no like easy three game series against the Pirates, because even the games against bad teams are divisional opponents that, hey, you still gotta go out there and beat those divisional opponents. So it's a huge litmus test for them, and I think it's not a bad thing that they're getting beat by the Dodgers right now. I think it shows them, like, you might feel on top of the world, you still have, there's still work to be done. I don't think that's a bad feeling to have in June. It's one thing if you're in September playing the Dodgers and you get swept, and that feels like kind of like a gut punch, like, man, maybe we can't do this, but you're still in a spot where you can get guys back, you can go out and acquire guys. It's not a bad thing to struggle against the Dodgers.
Exactly. And this is kind of similar to last year. I mean, like, last year the Mets were a completely different team. Like, they kind of fell off toward June. You know how they had that, like, West Coast trip where they played, like, the Giants, Dodgers, Padres?
And they went on a big losing streak.
They really struggled coming out of that. But this team feels a little bit different. Like, last year, I'd say the confidence meter going to that West Coast trip was, like, a 3 or 4 out of 10.
Yeah.
What's your guys' confidence meter right now out of 10 right now in the Mets going to this
gauntlet
of June?
It's like a 5.
Go ahead.
It's like a 5 or a 6, because I don't think they're going to go out here and just beat every team and win every series. I think they're going to struggle through this West Coast trip. I think the goal here is to play 500 ball. Your roster is not fully healthy, so it's not representative of what you know, you're going to be hopefully in the postseason. So I think your goal, especially against teams like the Padres and the Dodgers who are playing well, is play 500 ball, try and win the series against the Angels, because the Angels are kind of struggling. If you can catch them while they're skidding, that's kind of what the Yankees did. The Yankees came in there, swept the Angels, and that's what you have to do when a team's kind of down bad like that.
I just disagree that my confidence level would be in that 5 range. To me, this is such a gritty team that it's like, even without your pitching staff, I would say it's at least a 7 or an 8, given how they've played throughout the year. As you mentioned earlier, you can only play your schedule, and you know, you can't sleep through those games, absolutely. And they've shown up for all those games. They've come through with a gritty you know, passionate approach throughout their team. And it seems that in past years, they really didn't have that cohesive play for one another feel that they have this year. And,
Right. You
know, that's a huge part of baseball, feel, clubhouse atmosphere. And when you get into those, you know, dog days of summer, July, August, and you still have the camaraderie that the Mets seem to be brewing right now, I'm really excited for what the Mets, you know, have to offer us. So, 7 or 8 for my confidence level, at least, not in the ballpark of 5.
That's where you made some very good points.
I will say I'm more on the Miles side of things, because I just think, first of all, they have an 8.5 game lead over the Braves in a very weak
My
NL
confidence
with
the team in general is a lot higher than it is for them this month. I think this month I'm kind of expecting them to struggle. But I think the NL East, you're waiting for the Braves to wake up. If that even happens, because
I think
Philly's in a bad spot there. Right? They just fired Joe Girardi.
The Phillies are chopped.
R.I.P. Joe Girardi.
They're chopped.
That guy with the Yankees sometimes, but the Phillies are just a poorly constructed team, and I don't know that they're going to be able to turn it around.
Yep.
I like the Marlins.
They're
I
a
just
year
think
or two
that
away.
They got the pitching there. They need to boost up on the hitting, and
they're both
not in the same league as the Mets right now, and then the Nationals.
They're just a Juan Soto.
It's
Soto
not
show.
Even worth. Talking about, please trade Juan Soto. I feel so bad for the guy.
Yeah.
But, and that's what, like, you know, the Mets go into this LA series winning 6 straight games. They sweep Philly, they sweep Washington.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't riding super high on them coming into this series because I expect the Mets to sweep those series. And even though they're blowing out those teams, it's a completely different thing going from those teams to the Dodgers, right? But that's the thing. NL East, the shape that it's in, it's so weird to think about going into this season. A lot of people had the NL East pegged as one of the most competitive divisions in baseball.
Never.
I mean, when you look, you thought the Braves coming off a World Series were going to be good. The Phillies went out and spent, $240 million?
I was never in on the Phillies.
But it looked like they could definitely outslug some teams. And then I had the Marlins on my radar as a team that could come out and surprise some people. The NL East it's kind of been the gift that keeps on giving for the Mets, where they can kind of struggle. They can play .500. And they're going to be able to keep their lead in that division.
They will have it. Yeah, they're going to have a lead in the division. I just think the Braves are going to hit their World Series hangover. Phillies are chopped. Marlins are a year or two away.
I wouldn't rule out a Braves comeback. We saw it last year. I think there's enough talent in that. There's enough talent on
that
team.
There is definitely enough talent.
There's enough pitching where, like, I think the Phillies are a poorly constructed team. I think the Braves could maybe be a...
The Braves are
I think
the
Braves
thorn.
Are in a bad... I don't think that they're poorly constructed.
The disparity between the Mets and the rest of the division
is ridiculous.
Bigger
it's
than
still
any
big.
Division in baseball.
Oh, absolutely.
And no comparison, really. So it'd be shocking to see the Mets not take the division, absolutely. But there are, you know, it's not going to be an absolute cakewalk. Obviously, one of these teams is going to turn it on. You have the bats of Philly and championship experience of Atlanta. It's not like everyone's just going to go to sleep throughout the year. They play each other, you know.
And the Marlins are just like spoilers. They play spoilers.
I don't see the Marlins themselves.
I'm bigger on the Marlins. I'm bigger on the Marlins than I am on the Phillies. I still have
same,
the Braves.
Same. I agree.
I would not be surprised if the Marlins end up finishing third.
I think the Marlins are the third best team in the NL East. I'm dead serious. Like, the Marlins have the insane pitching. They have a couple of bats here and there. Jazz Chisholm's awesome.
They're
going to
be such a fun team when it all comes together. When they couple years down the road, they're going to be a legitimate threat to the East. And they're just going to be such a fun team to watch. They've been in a real rough spot for it feels like over a decade.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When they get...
Feels like my entire lifetime knowing baseball, the Marlins have never been
They're going to have a godly staff in a couple of years. You talk about Sixto Sanchez, you got Edward Cabrera.
Even Trevor Rogers has struggled a little bit. We've seen how good he can be.
What he is last year, and you pair that with Alcantara, Lopez, Sanchez, and Cabrera, that's 5 arms. That's a 5-deep rotation, potentially. And then I think they just got you get a couple more bats in there, and that's a really fun Marlins team. They play with excitement. You gotta love Jazz Chisholm. I think
Jazz.
I love Jazz.
I mean, look, their uniforms are sick too. Everything's up for the Marlins.
Miami colors are just
they're cool.
Just good colors.
The vibes are great when in Miami. But let's go back to the Mets. I think the Mets are. I believe in the Mets a lot more than last year, just because we've seen them win in so many different ways. We've seen them blow teams out. We've seen them win close games. We've seen them win ugly games and make crazy comebacks. Teams that can do that are the best teams in baseball. Like, the best teams in baseball, teams that can do that, they're for real. It's not a fluke. Like, blowing a team out every time, like, and then, like, playing a good team and getting killed, that's a fluke. You know.
And the things that I appreciate the most about the Mets, I feel like, are the intangible things, you know?
The little things.
Yeah, and it's the things that you feel like... everyone just gets along in a way that a championship team almost always has. The Cubs we saw in 2016 when they broke the vibes that were flowing around there. It really seems like everything's clicking right now for the Mets, and obviously right now they're on the West Coast, big test, but this is without their big arms. And once they get those big arms back, you know, this could really be the year for the Mets. This is a position that the Mets have absolutely not been in at all the last 5 years. So it's really something to be excited about.
You talk about those intangibles. I think it ties a little bit back to the hiring of Buck Showalter. And Tyler, you were spewing some slander about Buck Showalter before the show, and I'm just not going to stand for that. Buck Showalter,
one of the biggest
best managers in baseball.
He's
a guy. Don't interrupt me while I'm talking about my guy, Buck Showalter.
I'll let you have
your
Buck Showalter moment.
Got an Oilers shirt back home. Went to Camden Yards, bought a Buck Showalter shirt. Who does that? Me, because I love Buck Showalter, man. And this team, they're fundamentally sound. They're feeding off their manager. They love Buck. You could tell it, by the way. They're throwing birthday parties for him. They got pinata for him. Buck's talking about Shakir in the press conference.
Shakir, let's go.
That was a good one.
He's got the team in the right direction. Not that it was all Luis Roa's fault last year, but it just feels like Showalter's the guy that he steps in with the experience that he has. He got the team to buy into what he was selling, and they're just feeding off of him. I don't think you can undersell what Buck has done for this team.
Oh, definitely. And the vibes are unbelievable at the Mets. I mean, it just feels different. Like, it genuinely feels different. But before we head into a quick break, what's each of yours one bold prediction for the Mets in the second half of the season?
I guess I can go ahead and go first. Let me think. I think that they'll absolutely have a successful second half of the year. I think that it is a... I don't even know how bold this is. I think they take the NL pennant. I do. I think that the New York Mets take the NL pennant.
I think it is bold because the team that they got to fight for that is the Dodgers. But it's something that they can definitely
don't
do,
count,
Miles.
Don't count on a team like the Padres or even the Brewers if they get some offense.
As a Dodgers fan, I'm so pessimistic about the future of the Dodgers at this point in the year.
Really?
Just because
best team in baseball every year is enough for you?
No, it's not even about that. That's what I'm saying about the Mets. It's the intangibles. It's that when you buy players in the manner that the Dodgers buy players in, there's not nearly the same camaraderie in the clubhouse we had when we had Kike Hernandez, Alex Verdugo. These were self-made.
A young Cody
Jock
Bellinger.
Peterson. We had a feel in the clubhouse, a certain excitement and a vibe going that we don't have any longer, given that we now go out and purchase players in this way. Obviously, the Mets did a similar thing, naturally.
But I get where you're coming. It's a little bit different. I do want to ask
you this. The grit isn't there, to be honest.
As a Dodgers fan, like, does it feel like you're just sleepwalking through the regular
it does.
Season? Even though
and
you're
it
playing
almost
so well.
It always feels like that, to be honest. Because
you get that sometimes as a Yankee fan, because the expectation's always to win a World Series.
Right.
Yeah. It's like
you don't take
the time to appreciate the regular season. I think Yankee fans are doing it this year because this year feels special, but
it's fun.
I can see where you're coming from, right? The Dodgers, it kind of feels like the regular
you
season doesn't matter.
Exactly.
It's not
we
that
lose three games
there.
In Pittsburgh, and you know, and everyone's
how,
kind of like,
how was that?
Yeah,
by
how,
the way?
Yeah.
To
tell
be
us
honest,
a little bit about that.
It's kind of there's never that much of an intense feeling of fear or anything like that. How could you really feel like this is going to keep up?
I was just laughing because I was scrolling social media, and it wasn't even like Dodgers fans, they were mad. They're like, how are the Pittsburgh Pirates so good against us? Like, they're just in disbelief.
They took 5 of 6 against the Dodgers this season.
It's shocking,
is their season already over?
Yeah, it's over.
Oh, my God.
That really scares you.
Pirates own the Dodgers.
As something that could stay consistent, obviously. And
it's why I'm not surprised that the Dodgers came in and beat the Mets in the first two games. Yeah. You had to know they were steaming mad.
They took that personal.
Because they got made fun of for getting swept by the Pirates. The Pirates' social media was
oh, that was very, you saw
section.
That?
Shout out to the Pirates' social media staff. They are
great
awesome.
Job.
And that's simply not going to stay consistent. The Dodgers are so stacked. They know after a 3-game slide, they're not going to stay consistent at that level of play. So I absolutely do think there's a level of, you know, as a Dodger fan, you're sleepwalking through the regular season. You have these high expectations and you don't focus on the everyday games throughout the summer. But, you know, I'm pretty pessimistic about the Dodgers' playoff hopes this year, even though they're stacked as they are. But I think that they will make a run, but it's going to be the Mets right there with them at the end of the year.
All right, I'll give you my bold take. I'll try and make it quick. It's kind of a joke, kind of not. Luis Guillorme wins the batting title.
Ooh.
He gets enough play appearances. Listen, he's killing it right now. His batting average is at .360. So it's kind of a joke, but it's also a testament to look how good their depth is. That this is a guy they could take off the bench. Not a guy that I think they expected to be a starter this year, right? He's just kind of filled in whenever he's needed to, but guy's absolutely balling out, and I see a big second half for Luis Guillorme where he raises some eyebrows for sure. So that's my bold take.
Yeah, I'm going to go with a similar, I mean, to end the segment, I'm going to say something along those lines.
You're just going to steal my
thing? No, I'm going to go with Jeff McNeil winning the batting title. I think Jeff
Interesting.
McNeil, I don't know why, but I think everybody like kind of calms down, and then McNeil has like a hot run where he just like hits like ends up hitting like 330.
Quietly having a good year. We'll get into that, I think, in the All-Star
talk. He's been really
quietly
good.
Having a very good year.
Such a reliable guy.
He's been great, but you know,
good to see him back to doing what he's doing.
Of course, he had a rough year last year, but he's back, definitely. But you know, that will do it for Mets talk. We're going to head into a quick break right now before we cross the bridge and head over to the Yankees.
WFUV Sports One-on-One is sponsored by the U.S. Open. The 2022 U.S. Open Tennis Championships, the final Grand Slam tournament of the year, takes place in New York City, August 29th through September 11th. Multi-session tickets, plans, and more available at usopen.org.
We cross the Whitestone Bridge and head over to 1 East 161st Street, the address of the New York Yankees. And what can we say about this team? I mean, they are the best team in baseball right now, record-wise. They're red hot. Every time they feel like they hit a wall or hit a blip, they bounce back. And man, you cannot say enough about this team right now. They're 37-15. They're 6 games up on a quickly surging Tampa Bay Rays team. And the funniest thing is, I was reading the stat before. The Blue Jays just won like 8 in a row or something and lost one. They only gained half a game on the Yankees. It's ridiculous to see how strong this Yankee team is. But we're going to start off the segment with a little fun thing right now. We're going to send it over to Lou Orlando for a quick Yankees trivia.
Yeah, a little Yankees trivia for you. It'd be the first one to answer this correctly. You get a pair of tickets, Yankees versus Seattle, Tuesday, August 2nd at 7 p.m. So I'll cue this one up for you. Derek Sanderson Jeter, he's on Twitter and Instagram now.
Mm-hmm.
So he's got social media. 30 years ago this week, he was drafted by the Yankees. He's got a new ESPN doc about his career coming out. Hey, that's maybe why he's on social media. Not usually a big social guy, but he's been posting a lot recently. So we made the question about him today. What did Derek Jeter accomplish for the first time in baseball history in the season of 2000? Be the first person to answer that question directly. DM us at WFUV Sports on Twitter to get a pair of tickets for Tuesday, August 2nd, 7 p.m., Yankees versus Seattle.
You heard it first right here from Lou Orlando.
Yes, sir.
And then we got a little fun, another fun little promotion at the hands of the Yankees. On Saturday, June 11th, the MLB will celebrate Play Ball Weekend. The first 5,000 guests, 14 and younger, will receive a Yankees arm sleeve at the Pinstripes takeoff.
Look at arm sleeve.
Look at that. He loved arm sleeve. And then they're taking on the Chicago Cubs that evening. So, you know,
little,
you heard it here first.
Little Clint Frazier action, maybe. Is he on the MLB Cubs team still?
Is he
in the... I haven't kept up with Clint, but if he's coming, However you feel, if you love Clint, if you hate him, either way, it's a chance to boo him or root for him. So
I have no clue how Clint Frazier is doing. But you know, I have no clue how he's doing, but I wish him the best, and hopefully we get to see him.
Wish
but, you know,
all my former Yankees the best. Urshela, Voit, even Gary Sanchez.
Yep.
I liked Gary Sanchez.
Yeah, of course. I mean, listen, you can't even be mad about anything with this team. I mean, the vibes are immaculate with the Yankees. And, I mean, we saw it last night. First and foremost, you were at the game.
I was at the game. I was at the game in a Yankees jersey and a Rangers shirt. Got on the scoreboard.
Oh,
we had, had a couple of like Rangers things. Threw them up there when they showed the goal. They threw us on the scoreboard, so that was cool. And you know, was watching the Rangers doing a little multitasking.
Oh,
but
of course,
it's a good game to be in person for. As I think I was telling you this, you know, blowouts sometimes are boring to watch on TV, but when you're there in person, you get to watch the Yankees hit four home runs. That's cool. And when you get to watch a perfect game bid, that's pretty cool too. I think Katie Sharp throughout the stat. I want to get the year right, but I'm pretty sure it's 61
since the expansion era. So 61, yeah, you're correct.
So it's the first time that teammates have had perfect games through six innings in back-to-back games since 1961. So Tyone did it yesterday against the Angels. Cole does it against the Tigers. Or Tyone did it Thursday. Cole did it Friday. So, I mean, that's pretty cool. And that was something where, you know, sitting with my friend going, like, I didn't want to say the word, but I was like, you know, look at the scoreboard. Like, this is the second day in a row.
He's really pitching well,
He's
pitching we're not going to say anything.
He's pitching, I think the word I use is very good game.
Yeah, he's
kept
pitching.
Saying that.
He's really dealing is what I said. I wasn't going to say the word, and we know. But the Tyone one hurt a little bit more because it was a 0-0 game. That mattered a little more. But, you know.
the fact that they almost lost that game, that was a little scary. This one was a fun little laugher.
Oh, shout out to the Riz, though, for coming through for the Yankees on Thursday night in the second half of the doubleheader. Securing a Tyone win, because if Tyone came away with that with a no decision or a loss, I would have been emotional wreck.
If the Yankees lose that game after Tyone takes a perfect game into eighth, like, That's devastating. That's more devastating than the boost it would have been if he had a perfect game. Like that would have been absolutely brutal. So huge that Rizzo comes in that spot there. That's big.
Yeah, pinch hit double.
You know, Pascal, I know he's been struggling in May after a pretty hot April, but
back-to-back games
June,
with big hits.
June's looking pretty good for Rizzo. I feel like he had a good first game against the Angels when the Yankees they won 9-1. They hopped on that big first inning. Rizzo has an RBI double in that game. And then in the onslaught against the Tigers, Rizzo has a big three-run home run. Comes close to another one later in that game. So good to see him swing the bat well. Again, that's something where Yankees are doing so well that you don't want to nitpick too much. But there have been holes and gaps in the lineup. So you know, big to have Rizzo give some support to Judge, who's been amazing. Especially with Stan coming back today. But
there's another one. We got Stan.
Good to have him back. The lineup starting to kind of get back into what you expect the lineup to be. There's a point in that Tampa Bay series where you're looking at the lineups and you're like, this is not the team we constructed at the beginning of the year, and that's why you're kind of okay with splitting that series against Tampa. You win the first two.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we had like guys like Estefan Florial playing major innings, like playing a lot out there. You never really want that in a big series, but you know, the Yankees ended up splitting that series and then haven't lost since. It's weird. I mean, Rizzo, first of all, he got saved by the Rangers. Going to the Rangers game during the rain out, and getting showed on the. And then ever since, he's been lights out. So shout out to the Rangers.
Possibly the most impressive feat that's been accomplished in New York, including the playoff success of the Rangers, is Rizzo getting to MSG after the Yankee game got canceled.
That was actually hilarious because Rizzo was there like that. You see him. And it's like, what is it, like 1-0 or 1-1, and then Rizzo shows up, and then the Rangers just start getting hot.
I heard some conspiracies that he knew the game was canceled before they made the announcement. That's some people on Sports Talk Radio are talking about that, and I kind of have to agree.
Yeah, definitely. I mean,
so it's a little, I don't know how he gets to MSG in 30 minutes.
You know, Rizzo has his ways. Amazing. You know, don't ask, don't tell. Rizzo has his ways. But I mean, we could talk about the hitting. Let's talk about the pitching for a little bit. Jameson Taillon flirting with perfection. Taillon back-to-back eight-inning starts where he's dealt. Completely been a lights-out pitcher. Making an all-star bid for himself, actually.
Absolutely.
And then Garrett Cole making his shot at perfection last night. This pitching staff has five guys with sub-3.5 ERAs. How crazy is that to think of, first of all?
It's absolutely ridiculous. You're talking about the best pitching staff in baseball, in my eyes. No, the Dodgers are pretty good, but you have five guys that have just come out every day and shoved in they're working with two really good defensive catchers. Mm-hmm. They threw up the stat on the scoreboard yesterday. Trevino's got the best catcher ERA in all of baseball. I think we've got some sound. Mike Calamari got some sound from Trevino the other day.
We got some technical.
What was it about having back-to-back pitching performances from Jameson and Garrett? You know, what made that special?
That's huge. You know, me and Hagee take a lot of pride in that. I mean, we just go out there and we just try to give up, like, get as many zeros as we can, give our team a chance to hit. And I think we've been doing a good job of that.
It's Mike Calamari asking a big question, and it's good to see Trevino talking about that like that. And it was a big decision by the Yankees. They traded Gary and they went all in on, listen, defense. We might give up some offense at the catcher hole, but we're going to go all in on defense. And I don't know that anyone expected Trevino to be as good defensively or offensively,
offensively
as he's been sleeper bid for the All-Star game now when you talk about what Trevino is doing offensively. But we won't talk about that just yet. But, I mean, what you're getting out of them, I know you were trashing Higgy a little bit. Higgy's defense has been fantastic. His catcher ERA is low, too. But it really feels like this staff's in a good spot.
Mm-hmm.
The catchers, Higgy and Trevino, working together, working with the staff. And you know, when you have a guy that you can send out every day and you feel like, hey, you can get seven innings of one-run ball,
mm-hmm.
it puts your offense in such a good spot. This is an explosive offense at its best, and it doesn't need to be, though.
I mean, the pitching staff's ridiculous. The chemistry from the pitching staff to the two catchers is unbelievable. I mean, what's the highest ERA? Luis Severino? Severino's got like a 3.3 something.
I think that's the highest.
It's ridiculous.
ERA, and I think, you know, you would look at Seve, and it's really his first full year back from the injury
right.
he pitched out of the pen last year.
Seve's looked good,
too. He looks good, and that's the velo strong. His slider's good. I think
his changeup's good.
Now it's talking about kind of like working on limiting the base runners. He's gotten into mm-hmm. some trouble, but God, I think it was the White Sox game, right? He had some big strikeouts. I think they ended up losing that game because
I was at that doubleheader.
Offense
not
didn't
fun.
Give him any help, but you saw Pump Severino in that game, and so it's good. He looks like he's healthy, and I think that's mm-hmm. the biggest thing. And I think you're getting to a point down the road. Seve, you haven't seen Seve's best yet.
I will say.
I think you get a big second half from Seve. If you get into the postseason, I think you get a big postseason from Seve. So a lot to look forward to there if he's the worst pitcher in your staff.
That's not a problem at all. That's a really good problem to have, I will say.
Great problem.
And I will say, watching Luis Severino in person might be the most fun out of all the Yankee starters, as crazy as that sounds.
That sounds like slander to Nestor Cortez.
No,
I'm not going to stand for that.
No, hold on. I have not seen Nestor in person yet. That's why I will not comment on that. I have not seen Nestor in person, but man, the Seve scream after a big strikeout.
I mean, that it looks pretty electric. It looks pretty electric,
man.
Come on.
That will light
up
a stadium.
I'll agree with you. That
will light up a stadium for sure. I mean, all right, but let's talk about like the stories of this Yankee team. It just feels special in a way that like guys like Nestor, we got our own Ryan Gregoire and Mike Calamari did a like, nice little report on that.
They've done a Nestor report. They've done
a Clay Holmes
report. That's another great story.
Coming from Pittsburgh at
Shout
the trade
out
deadline.
To the Pittsburgh Pirates. They gave us Tyone and Clay Holmes.
And beat and
really
the Dodgers. Sorry, Miles. But, shout out to the Pirates for giving us the second best reliever in baseball behind Josh Hader for nothing, for Hoijun Park. And then another story, I mean, Nestor, a guy like Tyone, Tyone coming back from double Tommy John surgery.
Tyone's another
cancer.
Crazy story. The two
cancer,
Tommy
cancer. Rizzo coming back from cancer, another cancer survivor. But here's our latest great story. At the hands of Manny Banuelos, who got his first big career big league strikeout with the Yankees last night. After really having a really long, windy path to the bigs, getting drafted in 2008, being the top prospect for the Yankees in 2012, but kind of bouncing around everywhere, having a tough road to the majors. But he got his moment last night.
We got some sound from that, too.
We got some sound from Michael, our own beat reporter, Michael Calamari, on Manny Banuelos.
He's doing a great job.
Like I'm saying, I'm very grateful, you know. Just to be honest, I was there, and I was like, man, I was waiting for this for a long time. You know, I've been with a lot of different teams. I pitched in different countries, and it was a great moment. I want to enjoy that moment, like, before I start pitching. And I just say, thank God, thank to life, you know, to give me this opportunity.
And you can hear it in his voice, like, how grateful he is for the opportunity. He's not taking it for granted. And it's a throwback, right? He was part of the Killer Bees. It was Brackman, mm-hmm. Betances, and Buenuelos.
Yep.
And, you know, Betances really the only one that did anything for the Yankees.
Right.
Blanuelos pitches for Atlanta in 2015, Chicago in 2019. Stats aren't good in either of those years, and he makes his debut with the Yankees. First time pitching the Yankees after being drafted with them, it feels like forever ago. Two scoreless innings, allows one hit, gets the strikeout.
And his stuff looked good. He was hitting 95 with good off-speed movement. Hey, man, he's kind of good.
And listen, like the Yankees bullpen kind of surprisingly has run into some trouble. I mean, obviously there's the injury troubles. Chad Green out for the year. They've lost Loaizaca and Chapman temporarily to the IL.
Loaizaca struggling.
Loaizaca was struggling beforehand.
Very sadly.
And, Michael King was phenomenal the first month and a half, and then it feels like recently
running out of gas a little bit.
Recently, it's been a little bit of a struggle for him. If Buenuelos is a guy that ends up being productive, if you get anything from him in this bullpen, that's a huge win for him and for this Yankees bullpen. It's tough to judge that first game because, it's a blowout.
It's a blowout,
and it's against Detroit, whose offense has kind of been, comically bad to a point where it has to get better. But to see Buenuelos have that success in his first game, I mean, those are the stories you root for, man.
I mean, if you want to, have him fill in for, we know Zach Britton, another guy who—
and he's supposed to be coming back
soon,
too.
We've heard some progress from Brian Hoke himself, said, he might be back by August, and that's huge for a playoff run. If Britton wants to come back and be anything 2020 or of the past, not last year. The command wasn't there. He was probably pitching hurt. But if Britton wants to come back, that's a huge addition to this Yankee bullpen that has run into a little bit of trouble. But the confidence level right now is a 6 with the Yankee bullpen. When they were cruising, 10. This is a good bullpen.
I don't know that they need to get another arm. It's something they could look into. I'm kind of on the David Bednar train. We will talk about him later. We are going to talk about him later for sure.
Oh.
But he's absolutely dealing with Pittsburgh, which is not a statement you usually say. But no, he's been great. And you're starting to look at the teams that you think are going to be sellers. And yet, with the playoffs expanded, it's still a little early. So you're looking at the Pirates, the Nationals, probably the Cubs. And Bednar's the guy that really stands out as a reliever that you get. And, you wonder what you'd have to give up to get him. This is really his first year of excellence in the MLB. But I think it's a bullpen that could get away with not making too many moves. It's just guys have to start pitching in the back of their ball card.
Of course.
Loaizaca's got to go back to what we saw from 2021. Chapman doesn't have to be dominant best closer in baseball.
Just not give us heart attacks every time. He just has to be a productive reliever.
If Clay Holmes ends up being the closer for this Yankee team, that's not a bad thing.
That's a great thing.
You can't be scared to throw Chapman into every single game. That's my big ask.
Definitely. I think Loaizaca just has to make some adjustments. He made some unnecessary adjustments this offseason, changing from a lot of horizontal break on his pitches to vertical break. And those pitches have hung. See why his home run count's gone up. His hard hit count's gone up.
His fastball it's something that he's been aware of. I think the past few years, that's why he's developing the slider and the splitter, the most recent development, which is
disgusting.
At his best, that splitter is a nasty pitch, and he uses his slider a lot. I think sometimes he uses it too much for people's liking, but
it works.
It works sometimes.
It worked last year.
The fastball, it's not sitting at 101 anymore, but if you can get on top of that slider and that splitter, you're talking about still a very good reliever in the pen. I think, again, the pen is the thing I'm watching at this point because I'm not really worried about the offense. I feel like
not at all.
They're in a good spot where they have enough different bats. It feels like Judge can do no wrong.
Stan getting back.
You feel like this offense did a pretty solid job. I was worried about them coming off of the Tampa series, but then you saw them go off against LA with, again, not a fully representable lineup without Donaldson and Stan in that lineup. And without getting much from Gallo and Hicks this year, this offense is still doing a lot. So I think this offense can only grow. And so I'm not worried about the offense. I think the starting pitching is going to continue. I know it's tough numbers to really keep up, but it just feels like this Yankees pitching staff, it just feels like they're going to keep this going, man. I don't know what else to say.
It's absolutely ridiculous, this pitching staff. And the best thing is they've given the bullpen, you know how the bullpen's been shorthanded recently. They've given them length. Every single start, it feels like.
It feels like every game, man. The guys are going into the seventh inning and you're just dealing.
Exactly. Finally, we gave Jordan Montgomery run support the other day.
I feel bad for that guy.
Oh, my God. I feel so bad. What has he done to, the Yankees hitters, behind their back? I feel so bad. But then, Montgomery, they gave him run support, got him his first win of the season, which is so hard to believe. But giving Gumby run support, Taillon giving length, giving eight innings on back-to-back starts out of your fourth starter, which is absolutely asinine to think about. Like this, and then Nestor, and then Seve, and Cole being lights out yesterday. There's not a single weakness in the starting lineup, and it's crazy.
I wouldn't say that. In the starting rotation.
Okay. Excuse my words.
Talk about some weaknesses in the
lineup. The lineup you'll see guys step up, but the rotation has been absolutely ridiculous. But in
we were talking about weaknesses in the lineup. I wanted to get your take on this because we were talking about this a little bit earlier.
Sure.
Off air, Andujar gets sent down because now Stan comes back, and it's not that I hate the move. It's just that if the playoffs started right now, I think Andujar is in the starting lineup over Gallo and Hicks. And I know you had a different opinion than me. I just think I know that Gallo and Hicks have shown some flashes recently, but I think if you go into a postseason, you have to go with the guys that have actually been swinging the bat. And even though I think Andujar's stats, I don't think they necessarily reflect how well he's been swinging the bat. He's been making hard contact.
Yeah.
A lot more than Gallo and Hicks have, and not that I completely don't believe that Gallo and Hicks can get back to something of what they used to be, but I was a little surprised to see them send down Andujar when I felt like he was really in a good spot, finally getting consistent reps, looked good in the outfield. Defense has not been a problem with him at all. I think he made a fantastic diving catch a couple days ago, too.
Three defensive run saves in the outfield, which is really surprising, but really cool.
All right, that's a guy that has been statistically one of the worst defenders in the league, both at third base and in left field in years past, and it looks like he looks really smooth in outfield. You're not worried about fly balls hit to left field. Mm-hmm. With him out there,
I'm a little worried. I almost had a heart attack.
Speak for yourself. I think he looks so
smooth. He looks good.
I don't think you have a reason to be worried. He hasn't ever made like a misplay this year. He hasn't ever had like a falter where you're like, ooh, he doesn't look like a left fielder out there. He looks like a left fielder.
He looks good. It's just the reputation thing of Andujar being not a good
fielder.
Well,
that's on you for living in the past, man.
Of course. You got to always be a little wary. But no, Andujar's been good. I'm sure he'll get called up soon if a guy goes down.
I don't know. Because who would they send down? We were just talking. You can't really send down Marwin.
LoCastro, I guess.
LoCastro's hurt. He's not even.
He's coming back. He's doing a rehab.
And so that's another blocking point for Andujar getting called back up to the major leagues.
Yeah.
LoCastro's going to be on the major league roster because I don't think they're going to send down Marwin because even though his stats haven't been fantastic,
his
he can play every position in the infield and outfield. That gives you insane depth. It saves you a bench spot. You're not sending down one of the backup catchers.
No,
and you're kind of doing that thing where you have 10 starters and you're sitting a guy every day when this team's fully healthy. I don't know where the lane for Andujar is if this roster stays presently constructive, but it just kind of stinks because he's a major league hitter. He deserves to be in the major leagues, and it kind of stinks that he's going to have to go down to AAA and probably be there for a month or so.
If Frazier was still here, it would be the Andujar and Frazier for Soto train right now. That Yankee fans, no, I'm kidding. But it's not a bad problem to have. It's a good problem to have that the Yankees have so much depth on both sides of the ball.
I think it's still a problem though. If you have guys that are good that you can't play because you have too many guys, that's a little bit of a problem.
Late game situations, pinch hitting, I'm not worried about that. See, it's a good depth.
Right,
thing. It's
but it's you want your best hitters to be in the lineup every day. Like, we're at a point where Gleyber should be the starter every day, and he's gonna have to sit days because Donaldson's your third baseman. You're not gonna sit DJ, and so you have five starting infielders and only four spots for them really, unless you do the big man outfield, which. Who knows? Maybe they will do that more now that Hicks is really struggling and they've shown they're not afraid to sit Hicks and Gallo. Maybe we'll see Judge in center field every day.
Right.
I still don't know that that's the way to go. I mean, you want to keep Judge healthy. I think he looks fantastic
Judge likes
in center
it,
field.
Though. He likes center field.
Listen,
yeah.
If Judge can play center field every day, I'm all for it. I'm more just, I don't think the Yankees want to do that. And so it's going to kind of like DJ Donaldson and LeMay and Torres are going to have to sit days where they really shouldn't be sitting because they deserve to start every day.
Listen, in Boone, I trust. I trust Boone.
I'm a big fan of Aaron Boone.
I have went from not liking Boone last year till I think August. I made a turnaround where I was like, all right, Boone's really done a good job. He's really adjusted and learned how to do the bullpen usage. He's been good at that, working with lineups.
The bullpen usage got a lot better this year. I think it definitely helps the first couple months when it felt like whatever arm you threw out there was just absolutely dealing. But I think the way he's used Clay Holmes has been fantastic.
Michael King, too.
I was never on the hate Aaron Boone train. But I was of the belief that I would rather have Buck Showalter than Aaron Boone. I might still stand behind that just because I love Buck Showalter, but I have no complaints with Aaron Boone this year. And you really shouldn't when you look at how this team's performed. And I think when the Yankees are winning, Boone just comes off better. I think Yankee fans hated when they were losing. He's a player's coach.
Of course.
And he's defending the players. I think when they're winning, he has the angle to be a little bit more unbiased. He can kind of still be critical, but he's still a player's coach. Winning cures all. Boone right now. If they go into a slide, you're going to hear the fire Boone stuff.
Of course, but
I think he's done a fantastic job.
The thing about being a manager today, which was Joe Girardi's downfall, unfortunately for him, you got to be a people's person. You got to be able to manage a clubhouse and be able to relate to your players, be able to work with your players.
I think Boone understands his players, and I think
because he played the game,
you see a genuine love for his guys there.
Yeah, exactly. But there's never been a single bad report coming out about the team regarding Boone. Like, he is the people's person. The guys love him, love playing for him, and the energy just feels right. Obviously, winning cures all, as you said, but the energy just feels right this year. But, I did it with the Mets. We're going to do it with the Yankees. Final question. What is your one bold prediction for the second half of the season?
All right, let me think.
You got to get bold here.
Let me think a little bit. All right.
Take your time.
No, all right, so I think it's another half joke, not real. I think Jose Trevino wins the Silver Slugger in the American League for the catcher position.
Wow.
I don't see this guy not hitting. It felt like since May, since the Camden series, he got that first home run over the right field wall.
Oh, yeah.
All he's done since then is hit. Look up his stats. The plate appearances are a little low because he's splitting time with Higashioka.
I think he's in the 80s, but if he
gets consistent playing time, Jose Trevino for the Silver Slugger, look at some of his offensive metrics. He's got an OPS in the 8s. He's hitting .293. The average for catchers this year, it's like .217.
His WRC plus is like the 110s.
Trevino's crushing it right now, man. And you were talking about stories. I think he's one of the best, talking about a guy that's always been a Yankee fan growing up.
That walk-off
was special. But that's my bold take is Jose Trevino, Silver Slugger.
I'm gonna be honest, I love the take. I'm a little not wary, but I'm gonna sit back on that. But I do love
it's
that
partially
take.
A joke.
No, but partially not.
Serious.
My bold prediction is, Gallo has a midseason readjustment and comes on and just changes his reputation with the Yankee fans. Like, he goes from absolutely hated to love, because I think he's gonna fix it.
You think he's gonna pull a Stanton?
Yes, I think. I don't. Well, not to the extent of Stanton, but. His thing is, he's a very detail-oriented guy. His hitter, he switched his stance a little bit. If Dylan Lawson gets him back in the lab and fixes his stance just a little bit, I believe in Gallo would be a really good player again, because Gallo's a great fielder. I think that Gallo, because there's always going to be guys that hate him just because.
Yeah. People don't like strikeouts.
Yeah, Yankee fans are very stubborn, and once they're set in the way, they're set in the way. But a lot of them, I feel like a lot of people that are on the fence with Gallo that are starting to turn on him are going to turn back and like him again. Because I think that I still believe in Gallo personally, because I've seen what he can do.
I said this, right? The two biggest issues of the lineup have been Hicks and Gallo. And if I had to pick one that I still believe in, it's Gallo. Because I think Gallo, at his best, is it crazy to say top 25 hitter in the league?
Oh, no.
There's a couple years with Texas where he was legit. He was a guy that I think every team would have wanted. And I think
he's an analytical dream.
It's been a weird thing for Yankee fans. We heard all about this guy. We heard great power, great defense. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's going to strike out, but he's going to slug for you. We haven't seen great defense, and we haven't seen great power. And I think part of that is he won 2 Gold Gloves in right field. They got him in left field because we got that guy Aaron Judge in right. Yeah. And when he's in center, we usually throw Stanton in there.
Right.
Gallo looks good in right. He had the chance to play right with Stanton out. Gallo looks significantly better in right field.
If you look at him at the plate, he looks a little more comfortable.
I think his hitting stats, I was trying to do a deep dive. I don't know that there's enough there yet, but his hitting stats are better when he plays in right field, so maybe it's a little Gleyber Torres thing.
Yeah, I was thinking
but,
that.
But, definitely Gallo looks more comfortable in right. He even said it. He's more used to the angles there.
Yep, absolutely.
I could see a world where Gallo starts to do what he did in Texas a little bit more. I think no matter what, though, I don't think Yankee fans ever truly embrace him. I think it's been too rocky of a road, and even when Gallo's at his best, it's a weird watch.
It
doesn't feel, when his stats are good, it still doesn't feel like you're watching a great hitter.
Right.
So I don't think that he's ever going to be beloved by Yankee fans, but it's a strong take, and I like it.
And Gallo we trust, but you know what? That will do it for our Yankees talk. We're going to do a quick station ID before we come back with some headlines from Miles Grossman.
You're listening to One on One, New York's longest running sports call-in show on 90.7 FM, WFUV.org, and WFUVsports.org.
Welcome back into One-on-One, New York's longest-running sports call-in show. I'm Miles Grossman with some headlines for you at the top of this second hour. Thursday night, the Boston Celtics took Game 1 of the NBA Finals 120-108 in Golden State. It was a dominant fourth quarter, 40-16. The Celtics took that one. It was enough to outlast Steph Curry's 24. Al Horford came up huge in this game one, especially in the fourth quarter. He posted 26 on 9 of 12 shooting, and Tatum played the role of the facilitator that night, 13 dimes. And Tyler, most people thought this game was going to go Golden State's way. Obviously, you start the series in San Francisco. You have a star-studded lineup if you're Golden State. And it's a bit of this rising dynasty versus dynasty that might be on the decline here. So in your eyes, why did Golden State fall short in this game one, and what are they going to need to fix for game two?
Basically, I just think that Golden State, they kind of underestimated Boston's ability to move the ball, play team ball, and we saw Tatum. I mean, Tatum is their best player for Boston, and kind of shooting toward eights out there. He was struggling big time, 3 for 17, but he had 13 assists, career high. He kind of played that deep core role, and it's really cool to see Tatum take that playmaking leap this year. He went from a really good, like, really elite player to a superstar this year in terms of a complete player, offense, defense. And, you know, when his shot wasn't falling, he let Jaylen Brown to kind of take the reins. And then Al Horford, man, what
a performance.
You wouldn't think this is his first NBA Finals.
No.
Al Horford, Derek White stepped up, Marcus Smart stepped up. It's a next man up mentality. And I really like how the Celtics team is constructed. I think the Warriors make a big bounce-back effort in Game 2, but they really underestimated the ball movement and the ability. Like, the Celtics are a very complete team.
Exactly.
They underestimated the completeness and the ability to swing. There was so much ball movement. Like, when you saw, like, Tatum would drive in, swinging out to Jaylen Brown or Marcus Smart, and then swing it to Horford, and Horford would have an open three. Splash. And it was unbelievable. It was an unbelievable display of offense and defense in the fourth quarter for the Celtics.
And the Celtics have such a plethora of weapons. It's hard to stop them defensively if you're the Warriors. You know, when they're with their kind of ball movement, when they have their kind of depth and they're hitting on all cylinders like they were in that fourth quarter, it can be really difficult to shut them down. But I'm going to focus in on Jordan Poole. He's someone who earlier in the year I said he was my most improved player pick. He certainly should have been.
He deserved it.
Absolutely, at least a nominee at the end of the year, and he was not obviously in that top three. But Jordan Poole's absolutely made a huge leap this year. He's someone who's been such a shifty scorer, so quick, and he's had such a veteran presence on the court. And obviously in game one, that was not the case. Far from a veteran presence, it was really the start of the fourth quarter where Poole really showed how young he was. He looked like a true rookie.
You look bad.
Steph Curry's hanging out on the bench as they do. They'll bring Steph Curry in for the second half of the fourth quarter in a tight game, and when the game really got away from the Warriors is when Steph Curry's on the bench watching Jordan Poole run the offense. He had a couple really untimely turnovers, 4 turnovers in this one for Jordan Poole, and that really doesn't help. Only 2 for 7 from the field, 9 points. That's simply not going to cut it if he's taken on a borderline star role for the Warriors, and when he doesn't live up to expectations, the Warriors are not nearly as deep of a team as they need to beat a team like the Boston Celtics. So, Lou, it's tough. Do you see really a comeback performance from the young Poole and the Warriors? Or, you know, even in San Francisco, is Boston slated to take game two?
I think I'm still leaning towards Boston. I think it's a tough adjustment for Jordan Poole. Even, like, playoffs to finals, that's a huge leap.
And massive.
It's not a good thing to say that Otto Porter outshined Jordan Poole in game one. And You talked about it, being able to put Curry on the bench, throw Poole out there, sit Curry in some big minutes because Poole had been so good throughout this year and especially down the stretch.
Mm-hmm.
To have him struggle like that, to have him really be a major contributor to that loss, it's a big cut punch. I'm just looking at Boston. I think they're so much more well-balanced than Golden State. Golden State's defense has been terrific, but Boston's their defensive rating is the best in the league, the best in the playoffs.
Their defense is generational.
And I just felt like Golden State really struggled to stop Boston from scoring inside. And then when you have Boston, when they are scoring like that from outside, which was a huge surprise, I thought, to me, in terms of they kept up with Golden State. And we know how much Golden State loves to shoot from three. The only reason that Boston was able to keep themselves in that game is that you had Tatum and Brown and Horford singing threes like that. If Boston's going like that, that's a tough battle for Golden State. Not that they can't, you know, win a couple games there. I think their offense can definitely play better, but I think Boston's, we talked about being able to play different games, being able to play versatile. I think Boston has that more so than Golden State, and that puts them in a really good spot.
Yeah, I think what this finals proves to me is that depth is so important in the NBA. Both of these teams, really the deepest team in the West and the deepest team in the East, and they really play for one another. And it makes it difficult when both teams have as many offensive weapons as they do. It puts so much pressure on the other team's defense. And so far, obviously, Boston's defense has prevailed over Golden State. But Golden State's defense is nothing to slough over either.
Oh, they're phenomenal defense.
Exactly. So I think we'll see them absolutely make some defensive adjustments. You know, there were times where you thought, oh, that bucket just looked so easy if you're the Celtics. There's no way that a team with as much championship experience as the Golden State Warriors allows that to continue, especially back in San Francisco. So I definitely see the Warriors' defense tightening up a lot here in game two, but it really just goes to show how important depth is really what I'm thinking about here. And you have guys like Derek White just doing their job throughout the Celtics lineup. So, you know, Tyler, if you had to pinpoint a particular player on the Celtics team, given their depth, who's someone that's going to need to have a big game two for you for them to take that big 2-0 series lead?
Ooh, that's tough. First of all, I think Tatum bounces back. I think that's a foregone conclusion. But I'm not going to go with him because that's an easy one. I think Grant Williams is going to be key. Obviously, the Warriors are very deep. Their bench wings are really good. I mean, Otto Porter Jr., Andre Iguodala.
Yeah, they have the depth too. It's true.
Max Kellerman, if you're hearing this, I do not want Iguodala. I want Iguodala. But like even guys like Jonathan Kuminga play 1 minute. But like Kuminga is a great young player. They got obviously Poole, in the starting lineup, Wiggins, Draymond. It's going to be important for the Celtics. The Celtics have the wing advantage, I'd say, easily. With Brown, Tatum. It's going to be very important for those wings to step up because the Warriors have so much experience and they've been here before. The Celtics, how many of them? They have, what, zero playoff finals experience? I don't think any of them have finals experience.
Is it goose egg?
The Warriors have been here so many times before. And that's why, like, I'm still confident in the Warriors. I'm not jumping, like, oh, my God, panic. Hit the panic button. Yeah. Jumping off the bandwagon. I think the Warriors will be fine. It's just that, the Celtics are a much, much tougher team than the Warriors gave them account
and
for.
Some important, you know, betting information just for bettors out there. If you do like the Warriors to make a comeback, they're +145 in the series. And there's a lot of value there if you really think about it, Warriors with the home court advantage. But just had to put that out there. See that Warriors comeback coming.
There we go. Miles Grossman with the great betting information. But I will say, the Warriors, it's not panic button time for the Warriors. Yeah. The Warriors have been here before. They have a great home court advantage. Chase Center always gets loud, always gets up for games. It's just the Celtics really just came out and just took the life out of the building in the fourth quarter. And I think the Warriors take game two personally, just because I think they're not going down 2-0 at home. Not happening.
I'd be surprised if they fell down 2-0 as well. But given where the Celtics have been at in the recent weeks, they sure look like the best team in basketball by a significant margin. Just so complete at every level. There's a lot of three-level scores on this Celtic team. But Lou, I know you watched this game. It's the NBA Finals. It's the most fun time of the year in basketball. When you're watching an NBA Finals game, the atmosphere in the arena is just different from any other playoff series. The intensity, there's nothing like it. And obviously the Warriors have seen that level of intensity year in and year out. They have such veterans on this team. How big do you see that disparity in experience being throughout the rest of the possible six games?
Listen, I think the experience for sure is huge with them being used to that environment, used to that atmosphere. It's something you can't practice for. No matter what you do, you can't practice for what it's going to feel like when you step onto the court for a finals game.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things where that experience, it's irreplaceable, and it's something that if you have it, it's a huge asset. So I am kind of with you, Tyler. I feel like the Warriors bounce back. I don't see them going down quietly. The one thing I'm wondering is, in this place, have the Warriors faced a team that's as good as Boston?
Because
I'm looking at Boston, right? The path that they've made, having to beat Brooklyn, who a team similar to Golden State, where they've got the stars, they could shoot from beyond the arc. Milwaukee's another powerhouse team. I thought Miami, weird enough to say, was probably the least powerful of the three teams they played in the postseason.
And they gave them the hardest series too.
It feels like Boston's had the harder path to the playoffs. They've been used to this tough competition. I feel like the Warriors, they have to amp up for a different level of a competition. I feel like there was a lot of talk about the Mavericks being kind of a bad conference championship matchup. That wasn't a team you expected,
absolutely,
I think, to get there, right? We were talking about it as
it's
Luka, and then it's who else is even gonna show up. And the Warriors handled them pretty easily. Now they have to deal with a team that's got great depth. And you said they look like the best team in the NBA. I think it's a little bit of an adjustment for them. I think maybe that's what you saw in game one. I think their playoff experience allows them to make that adjustment quickly. Again, they've played amazing teams in the finals before. Look at some of those Cavs teams.
Like LeBron and Kyrie.
I think they'll be up to the test.
They played a tough Raptors team. I think they'll be fine. I think the Warriors, the thing is, they have, like, obviously they have so much experience. They have every single guy has been here. I mean, Draymond is a ridiculously good
leader. It's important to mention when you have the experience conversation that while Draymond and Clay and Iguodala and Curry have been there plenty, obviously Iguodala doesn't get all that many minutes. There's a lot of guys who are really a big part of the Warriors' attack who are just as inexperienced at this stage of the finals
as Boston.
Exactly. Jordan Poole, it really shined through in game one.
Jordan Poole
looked like he had never been in a finals atmosphere before, and he sure hasn't.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think that you have guys on Boston who are, you know, just professionals, adult basketball players who don't necessarily need the experience to shine through and show what they're really about. You have guys like Al Horford's obviously a veteran, and for their age, Tatum and Brown are some of the most poised stars in our league.
Yes,
absolutely,
because they've been there so many times before. Like, they got to the league like 19, and they made the playoffs right away. They made Tatum rookie year conference finals game seven against.
So while they might not have the finals experience,
they're almost there.
They're sure adult basketball players. They're sure poised, and you know, Curry to me is gonna have to play more minutes than he's comfortable this series. I think, you know, he's an aging Curry at this point. That's an important factor to recognize. And the Warriors are going to need every last ounce of Curry magic that they can get out of him in this series. I think that was really obvious in game one because, you know, 34 out of Curry. There were some moments in the, obviously, he was held to zero in the second quarter and
a
huge defensive adjustment by the Celtics that was very clutch. But first quarter, 21 points, held to none in the second. But when you have a guy like Steph Curry who can obviously give you 21 in any given quarter, he's such an electric scorer. It's sure going to be a fun series the rest of the way, that's for sure.
Absolutely.
Look at what Jimmy Butler had to do, basically playing the entire game just to keep Miami
afloat
in that series. I think it's a similar thing with Curry. Going to need him to step up in this postseason environment. I think a lot of the talk's been on they're saying this is the first playoff series where he's been the main, he's had to be the main guy. I mean, you could make the case.
Yeah,
2016, those two years. He was probably
the main guy, definitely.
But I mean, Clay was on a pretty special level too, and you have Iguodala winning the Finals MVP there. It's a lot of the onus is on Curry here to step up and try and take down the Celtics team.
And there were two really pivotal stretches during this game one to me. It was that second quarter where Curry wasn't playing all of it, but he was held to 0 points in the second quarter. And it was that fourth quarter where Steph Curry is sitting on the bench for the first half of the fourth quarter. Jordan Poole is running the offense. And that's where the Celtics absolutely took advantage and ran away with this game. It was 40-13 at one point in the fourth quarter.
Yeah.
The Warriors bang a three to make it 40-16. It was a meaningless three-pointer. You could basically chalked it up to being a 40-13 quarter, just an absolute slaughter. So, you know, those two pivotal stretches were mainly without Curry. So it's going to be, you know, it seems that, you know, in prior series, the Warriors were not so Curry dependent.
Yep.
And now that the way the Celtics are able to lock up the Warriors, it seems that now maybe they are becoming a bit Curry dependent, and given where Curry's at in his career, he's not someone who you want to get 45 minutes out of, 43 minutes out of. You want to have him some time on the bench, especially that key period where they always seem to rest Curry is the first half of the fourth. They want him full yep. strength, coming back for the pivotal last few minutes. And that's going to be, you know, we might not see Steph Curry sitting the first half of the fourth quarter in a pivotal game five or six or seven. So it's going to be interesting. But before we wrap up here with our finals talk, I want to turn to both of you guys. What do you see as your finals prediction? Ooh. The Celtics have now a one-game lead. They've eliminated the Warriors' home court advantage. Tyler, I'll turn to you first. What's happening in this year's NBA Finals?
I said it before the series in my head. I'm going to stick with it, even though, you know, the Warriors didn't look too hot. Experience shines through, and they're getting a guy like Gary Payton, the second back, who's going to be huge as a massive defensive piece in the second unit. They're getting all their guys back healthy. I'm sure guys will step up. Warriors in seven.
I'm torn between Celtics in six and Celtics in seven. I think I'm gonna go Celtics in seven because I do think that this Warriors team is gonna fight back. Tyler, you're right. That experience, it is valuable. I just feel like this Boston team has been special this yeah. run, man. It's kind of hard to envision that it not ending with a win. It's just kind of been that perfect storyboard run for them. And I see it ending. I think it goes to game seven, but I see Boston on top.
I'd agree with you, Lou. Celtics. I'm going Celtics because it does seem like they're a team of destiny at this point.
Right.
And, you know, everything's flowing. They're, as we mentioned, they're battle-tested in this playoffs. They've seen the worst of the Eastern Conference Finals. I think coming out of that Milwaukee series, it was definitely whoever wins the Celtics-Milwaukee series was the NBA champion in my mind. And I said that back then, and hopefully I will be proved correct when the Celtics take it in maybe even six games, I'm going to go with. So Celtics in six.
You were on the same
page. Exactly. You guys are on the same page. Okay. Perspective.
But the Celtics have so much depth, and when you already can eliminate a team like the Milwaukee Bucks, you've seen the worst of what the NBA has to offer you. The Golden State cannot say the same thing. So I'm going to go with the Boston Celtics. But it sure has been a fun year. And I think really the message from this NBA Finals is that, WNBA just a few minutes. But
just you wait.
The message from this NBA season is depth, is when you have the amount of weapons is so important. Both these teams, an absolute plethora of weapons from Derek White to Jordan Poole on both ends. It's just amazing that, you know, it might not be about having a big three at this point, which
absolutely.
It always seemed
You cannot buy a championship anymore.
You cannot. And that's what I think, in particular with these Boston Celtics, are proving that. Because for maybe 10 years in the NBA, it really looked like you needed a star big three to rely on. And that was
not
how
anymore.
Teams were looking to win. Not any longer. Obviously, both teams can make a case they have a big three, but it's not the big three that have gotten them here whatsoever. It's been the depth. It's been the bench guys. And so, you know, that's where we're at in the NBA today, and I'm happy that that's the state of the NBA.
I agree. I love it. You know what? But may the best team win. That's all we can say. May the best team win, and thank you, Miles. But we're going to head into a quick break before we come back with some Stanley Cup playoffs discussion with WFUV's very own Rangers beat reporter, Colin Loughran.
Hey everyone, I'm Will Grant.
And I'm Chris Persiainen.
And we're two of the hosts for WFUV's very own basketball podcast, Pick and Pod.
Tune in weekly for updates and our takes on the latest around the NBA, as well as exclusive insight from our very own Knicks and Nets beat reporters.
We'll have you covered on everything from all the NBA's latest drama we know and love,
to debating all year long which team will get to lift that golden Larry O'Brien in June.
So don't miss a beat from the hardwood on WFUV's Pick and Pod.
We're back in the Big Apple with a red-hot New York Rangers team taking a 2-0 lead over the two-time defending Stanley Cup champions, Tampa Bay Lightning. I mean, Lou and I, you see it ourselves. We're repping the Rangers hard. Lou's got the Brooklyn Cyclones, too. So, you know, it's all New York-themed show today, of course. But we're going to be joined by WFUV's very own beat reporter, Colin Loughran, to discuss the Rangers' run to the Cup.
Let's
Colin,
go.
How are you?
I'm doing great today, Tyler. Lou, I hope all is well with you guys. I'm doing even better considering last night's result for the Rangers. What a win. You're now two more wins away from reaching the Stanley Cup Final. And considering how this team started their year by being obliterated by the Capitals on opening night, 5-1, then you go home and you lose to the Dallas Stars in OT, 3-2. I was there for that. This is even more amazing because I don't think anyone in media or even fans thought they'd make it quite this far.
I mean, as Ryan Mead of Blue Shirts Breakaway says, why not us? but this playoffs run has been so peculiar. I mean, two game sevens, crazy comebacks, just wild games. Every single game feels like it just feels special. But what's been the biggest difference between the Carolina series to you and the first two games of this Tampa series?
Spacing is so critical in today's game of hockey. It's the reason why a team like Edmonton looked so good early in the postseason and now seems to struggle against a unit like Colorado. Tampa has offered the Rangers a lot of free real estate on the ice, whereas Carolina was really solid on the forecheck. They were good at really clogging the neutral zone and making sure you're not getting easy pucks through into the ozone. If you give the Rangers and Adam Fox space to operate, they're going to make you pay for it. I mean, Fox has been having an incredible postseason run. He's now 6 assists away from tying Brandon Leetch for the most in a single Rangers postseason.
Colin, you come off that seven-game series against Carolina. You talked about it, the intense forecheck. It felt like every possession was a battle to get through the neutral zone. And now it's got to feel like the ice is wide open. Is that an adjustment Tampa is going to have to make when we get further on in this series? Because right now, the Rangers are dominating possessions, they're dominating the puck, and they're dominating the neutral zone.
I think Tampa's going to have to make quite a few adjustments. I'm not sure if they're going to be able to get tougher on the forecheck the same way that Carolina could. I just don't look at that roster as the type of unit that can turn it on and off in a heartbeat. What they can do is get tougher defensively. I'm looking to guys like McDonough to really step up their game in front of the net, in front of Vasilevsky more specifically, because he struggled a little bit early. If they're going to make any sort of adjustment, it has to be on the defensive front, because I just don't see their forecheck applying the same pressure as a Carolina.
Absolutely. So, Colin, I mean, you've been covering the team for a while now, but what's been your favorite moment for the Rangers' playoff run so far? What's been your singular favorite moment?
Oof. That's tough. There's been a lot of great moments. I am torn between Game 7 against Pittsburgh, and I'm going to cop out here because I wasn't there for it, obviously, but Game 7 against Carolina might have been one of my favorite moments, too, because it was just so improbable. See, they were supposed to beat Pittsburgh the way the season was going.
Yes, absolutely.
That was becoming the narrative. Was, okay, they're better than what we all thought they were. Now they should win the playoff series, and you know what? If they lose against Carolina, it's still a successful season. When you go up to Raleigh in Game 7, the thought was, oh, well, you know, it's kind of 50-50. The fact that they won that game really showed everybody what this team was made of, and it really showed what the young guys are made of. That kid lineup, Hedl, Lafreniere, Kako, they have been great. They were great in Game 7. They've been great against Tampa Bay so far. And to me, that win in Raleigh is the signature moment of the season.
Well, Colin, you mentioned him, so I'm going to ask you about him. To me, Filip Hedl has been the surprise of the postseason. I've loved the kid line, but this is a guy that has really stood out to me in this postseason. He's had a crazy burst of late. Only scored 7 goals in the regular season, 8 goals in the postseason. Is this something you saw coming, and can this be a catalyst for him becoming the player he's kind of been expected to be? This is a top prospect that I think we've been waiting to develop for a couple of years now. It looks like he's finally coming into his own.
You know, I think it's funny you bring up Filip Hedl because there's been so many comparisons in the Rangers locker room to other past Rangers players. Like Adam Fox is always compared to Brian Leetch, obviously. Filip Hedl has been compared to someone like a Mika Zibanejad because they've told him they want him to play like Mika Zibanejad. That's the only reason he warranted those comparisons early in the year, was Coach Gallant had said in some sort of press conference or told a reporter, oh, well, I told Phil I'd like him to play like Mika. Now, I don't think that Filipino is quite like Mika Zibanejad in the two-way sense, but in terms of scoring, he has a lot of the same characteristics. Does he have the one-timer like Mika? No. But as you're finding out on the break, he's filthy. So his development has been critical to the success of this Rangers team because amongst that kid line, yes, Lafreniere can score. Yes, Kako's really good down low around the net. Eagle's the one guy that on the break, you want him to have the puck.
Absolutely. You see, the development of Filda, that's his nickname, Filip Hedl has been an absolute revelation. And like, how much has that kid line impressed you? This is their first playoffs together. You never expect a kid line or like young kids to come into the playoffs and succeed in the way that they have so far. What's impressed you the most about the kid line? Was it the composure, the chemistry? What is it to you?
Initially, I think I was most impressed by the fact that they were able to be so productive together. People forget at the start of the year, Kaapo Kakko was with Kreider and Zibanejad. Towards the middle of the year, Lafreniere was on that top line. So I knew these were all great players. The question was, could they coexist together because of that age and be productive? And I've been floored by the amount of pressure they've been under and yet how they've still competed so well. I mean, look at who they're playing out there. It's not like they're playing Humpty Dumpty. You go up against Carolina or Tampa, you got to have your best hockey with you, and the kid line's done that. For me, the only surprise has been that they've been able to do it together.
Absolutely.
Colin, I want to ask you about these two games coming up. I think you can draw a similar parallel to the Rangers-Carolina series. Carolina wins two at home. Then the Rangers came, and they got to their home ice. They won two and evened up the series. Do the Rangers need to steal one in Tampa here, or can Tampa even it up and the Rangers are still in a good spot?
That's tricky. If they had lost last night, then I'd say you have to win one in Tampa Bay. But just knowing the momentum that they have, I mean, this is Tampa Bay's first consecutive playoff loss since 2019. All of the momentum is on the Rangers' side right now. So in my mind, do you have to win in one in Tampa? Probably not, because you're going to come back to the Garden and you played like world beaters there. But the coach in me says you have to steal one for the sole purpose of Tampa Bay's champion. You still have to respect that. So if you can steal game three or four, then you head back to the Garden with a chance to win it in game five. So stealing one away on the road gives you a luxury that you wouldn't have if you dropped both.
Absolutely. I feel like the collective confidence level of Ranger fans right now is much higher than it was coming into the series. I mean, this series, the Rangers, even though they have home ice advantage, they're still considered by most underdogs, considering it's Tampa. I mean, back-to-back champions. You're always going to be the underdog going in. But I feel like they're playing so much more loose. Like, look back at that Carolina series. They played so restricted, so composed. Do you think that Game 7 in Carolina, where they absolutely obliterated the Hurricanes, freed up the Rangers a lot more? Obviously, you talk about spacing earlier, but do you think it's freed up the Rangers to play a lot more, like, just free-flowing?
I think it's a combination of things. I think when you're more confident, you're able to play that style of hockey, but I also think it's just a personnel mismatch right now. Tampa's got some tired legs out there to the extent that Carolina didn't have. They had, for the most part, guys that were young, hungry, and ready to go. So I think when you combine that with the Rangers being so young and so good in open ice, it allows you to play a different style of hockey than maybe they had been allowed to do previously. I'm looking at the latter half of this series, and really the kid line could be key. That top line for the Rangers is accruing a whole lot of lost energy, if you catch my drift there. I mean, Kreider, Zibanejad, Vetrano, those guys have really been relied on a lot to chew up ice. And same thing with Adam Fox. I know he's been amazing this postseason, but that wears and tears. So if I'm looking at the latter half, you might be onto something in that it will slow up a little bit as we shift to Tampa. But for the most part, I don't see the open ice situation changing that dramatically or reverting back to where it was against the Hurricanes.
This series was kind of marketed as a battle of two of the best goalies in the NHL, possibly the two best goalies in the world. You have Vasilevsky, who's been really the guy for the past couple of years, and Igor, who was the best goalie in the league this year. Igor's lived up to the hype. Vasilevsky, not so much through the first two games. And that, you know, you look at his record against the Rangers, going back to the regular season this year, 0-5, allowing four goals a game. is this a case of just a bad stretch for Vasilevskiy, or do the Rangers have his number?
I think for the most part, the Rangers are beating Vasilevskiy the way you're supposed to beat him. Like, he's the type of goalie where you're not going to jam a lot of pucks through the net up close. You're going to have to try and beat him in space. Igor is a bit of the same way. I think he's better with the puck, which means that if you're close up to Igor, he's going to shut that down and not get too clumsy there. Vasilevskiy's just been struggling with the Rangers' speed, from what I've seen. There's been times where the puck has shifted from east to west, and he just can't get to it to save his life. That could be sore legs. That could be lack of energy, fatigue. Whereas on the Rangers' end, they have good defensemen right now in front of Igor, which is making his life a little bit easier. And even when Lightning get a break or get a big opportunity, I mean, that shot by Stamkos late in the game last night that could have tied it up, it was a great save by Igor made there. And partially, I think that's because of the type of goalie he is, where he's very comfortable in those close quarter situations. Like, even if you get the puck in the slot, it's not guaranteed that you're getting it by Igor. And moreover, if you get it on the break, you best believe that you're going to have to shift it over quickly from east to west, because Igor's got the flexibility to get over there pretty quick. So I think in conclusion there, the Rangers have Vasilevskiy's number, but I think their offensive push goes against the very thing that Vasilevskiy's a tad weaker at later in his career.
One last question for you, Colin, before we let you go. If the season ends today, who is your personal Rangers playoff MVP, like the Conn Smythe? Who do you think it is?
Adam Fox. It has to be Adam Fox. You are six assists away from tying Brian Leetch for the most in a single Rangers postseason. Rangers fans know that name is legendary here in New York. For me, you need a solid defenseman if you're going to make a Stanley Cup push like the one that they have. And I would not want anyone else on my team personally than Adam Fox. I know there's a lot of people that would take Mark Carr over Fox. I know Charlie McAvoy up in Beantown has also gotten some respect as of late. But to me, the two-way ability says it all. Adam Fox has been MVP because he's done the small things. On defense, he fights hard. On offense, he's not scoring all the time, but he's the one that can kind of set the table for everyone else to do their thing, especially that power play unit.
Absolutely. Thank you again, Colin, for coming on and joining the show with us today. Have a good one. Hope to hear from you soon.
Thanks, guys. Have a good one.
Take care.
Dude, Colin Lochran, legitimately one of the best beat reporters we have on the station, especially Absolutely. When it comes to hockey. I don't want to insult any other hockey reporters, but I don't know if there's anyone more knowledgeable than him. Like, he interprets the game in a way that the average fan just doesn't. So if you ever need any hockey reports, you go to Colin Lochran, although Quiggs does a fantastic job.
Quiggs,
as
great
well.
Job.
They're both. That's yep. a powerhouse beat reporting crew, and you have Quiggs and Lochran in the same sense. That's amazing. But Colin brought up a lot of really impressive things, and I liked what he talked about, especially with Vasilevskiy, because that was something. I don't think it's a fluke that the Rangers are scoring on Vasilevskiy like this. One of the weaknesses that Steve Valiquette on the MSG postgame, he mentioned it as soon as the Rangers beat Carolina in Game 7. They started looking ahead to Tampa, started looking ahead to Vasilevskiy, because that's the big story. This is one of the greatest goalies of our generation.
Absolutely.
And he said his weakness, it's a little bit above the block side. And in this postseason, he's allowed 34 goals, 21 have been on the blocker. And if you look at the Rangers' goals, in Game 1, Kreider beats him above the blocker. Vetrano yep. nails one above the blocker.
Absolutely.
Panarin sinks the final goal of that game above the blocker. And then the final nail in the coffin of Game 2, Mika Zibanejad above the blocker. So they're hitting that spot. The Rangers did their research.
Absolutely.
And really, they're making one of the best goalies. And they, like, don't get it twisted. Vasilevskiy is an incredible goalie.
Stud.
The fact that the Rangers put 3 goals on him after a loss, I think there's some crazy stat that Vasilevskiy has a .995 save percentage after a loss. Like, he's ridiculous.
No, absolutely. He is. Well, for the series, there was debate about, like, Shesty or Vasilevskiy.
The Rangers fans are chanting Igor's better, and Igor
Which
has
I do
been
not,
better.
I do not like that, by the way. I think it's stupid. Do not
listen.
Do
you don't
want to
rile Vasilevskiy up.
Do not give Vasilevskiy the fodder, please.
Igor's been better in this Absolutely. Series, but Vasilevskiy has the resume. He's been that guy for a few years. This is really Igor's first year as an elite goaltender. But you have to be thrilled with the Rangers on home ice take two against the Lightning, and all this talk about, hey, maybe they can only score against backup goalies. I think that goes out the window when you score six and then three against the best goalie in the league.
Absolutely.
Like, that's I think all that talk about only scoring on backups, they struggled more against the backups than they did against Vasilevsky, and that's funny.
It's absolutely hilarious. Like, Louis Domingue and Antti Raanta gave the Rangers more trouble than Vasilevsky has.
Louis Domingue gave the Rangers a world of trouble. DeSmith got hurt in the first game. Domingue came in, I think, in overtime or in the third period?
Third period, I believe.
He came in the third period. Rangers couldn't get anything against him for three periods.
Fresh legs.
Struggled against him really through the first four games.
Fresh legs of Louis. And then they really picked it up, obviously, and then they started just getting comfortable. It's Vasilevsky. He's tired. He's got tired legs. He's played, three deep postseason runs in a row.
Does he have tired legs? He got 9 days of rest, man.
That's
one of the things I wanted to talk about.
Let's talk about 9 days of rest,
with
actually.
Tampa, because there was all this talk about 9 days of rest, the Rangers only coming off of 1 day of rest.
Yep.
I went into this series thinking Rangers are going to take the first two games,
right, because they have the momentum.
They're riding high off of a 7-game series against Carolina. You come back to Madison Square Garden. They've only lost one game in Madison Square Garden. There was the first game. It was a triple overtime game against Pittsburgh. Yep. They played really well, and they get beat in an overtime goal, right? Every other game they've won in MSG. So to come off that tough series against Carolina. Again, Carolina, a nightmare opponent for the Rangers with that forecheck. To win that game 7, I think you want to just dive into the next series, especially you have the first two games at home. I'm looking at 9 days for Tampa. I don't care that they're experienced as a playoff team. 9 days is just too much.
It's too much,
I think you saw a little about that. I know people talked about the rust. I think they were a little rusty. I think it took them... It's so hard to get back up to playoff intensity. People talk about how fun the Stanley Cup playoffs are to watch. One of the reasons for that is because the players, they play with a different level of intensity. It's just different. And no matter what you do in practice, you can't replicate that. So the Rangers go. They're on their normal schedule. They take a day. They play another game. They just played a game 7 against Carolina, fighting for their lives. It's super easy to dial back up the intensity. You're going up against Tampa Bay.
Yeah.
Tampa Bay swept Florida and then had 9 days off. They really hadn't had to play that many high-leverage games in the past two weeks. You have to all of a sudden get back up to that playoff intensity in a really tough arena to play in. I expected Tampa to struggle. Now, the one thing, and I'm interested to hear your take on this, I think maybe the fatigue sets in a little bit here. Tampa gets to come home. They've got two games to kind of get the rust off. I think they're going to be sharp. They looked better in game 2 than they did in game 1.
Absolutely.
I don't know if fatigue sets in for the Rangers necessarily, but I think the tables start to turn. You have to play in an away rink. It's not Carolina, but Tampa, it's nothing. It's really nothing to shoo away either. And so Tampa gets home advantage. I think Tampa, the favors in Tampa for these next two games.
Oh, absolutely. The favors in Tampa. They get home ice advantage. They get to go back to a familiar crowd. That being said, I just think the Rangers, like right now, they're playing so much more loose. Colin mentioned it. First thing, spacing. Carolina plays such a boxed-in system where they clamp down on everything. They're faster than the puck. They're so intense. They're so well-coached by Rob Brind'Amour. He did such a great job limiting the goals and making it a low-scoring series for the first, first four or five games of it. John Cooper's a phenomenal coach, first of all.
Absolutely.
I mean, there's a reason why he's back-to-back Stanley Cup champions.
One of the greatest coaches in the sport. You can legitimately have that conversation.
Absolutely. And he's able to adjust on the fly. That's why he's so good at what he does. That being said, I think that Tampa is a much, much, much better matchup for the Rangers than Carolina.
I think Carolina was the worst matchup in the entire league
for
the Rangers.
And the Rangers got past that. They got past the hump. And doing it on the road in Game 7 in an unfamiliar environment, but a tough environment, It's not easy to play there. Not at all. Especially the way Carolina plays. Tampa's able to do that. And I mean, Tampa plays a lot more loose, a lot more star power, but, a lot more like open ice, let the players play.
Listen, they're trading the heavy forecheck. They're not going to do that. They don't have
the
players to do that, but
nope.
they have the offensive talent that Carolina simply doesn't. And that's when it helps to have Igor Shesterkin.
I mean,
to have him just stand on his head at times. I mean,
dude,
you talk about the end of game 2, he had to face a flurry of shots.
I almost had a heart attack watching
and
that.
Really just stood in his head, and the one gets in, but you're not going to blame Igor when he's had just a couple of fantastic games. I'm so curious to see how these two games in Tampa go, because I think if the Rangers can win game 3, I think it's a 4-game sweep. I think if Tampa wins game 3, you're probably talking about coming back to MSG with an even 2-2 series.
I could agree with that.
I'm not ruling out that the Rangers could then come back and win game four. I think that the home ice advantage for Tampa, it's simply not a conversation the way it was with Carolina. The home ice advantage for the Rangers is absolutely a conversation. Oh, there's something MSG. About MSG. They play up for that. So I'm not too worried about – I think the Rangers could absolutely steal one. I wouldn't even be surprised the way you would have been surprised if they stole one in Carolina when they did.
Right.
But I'm so curious to see how they play on the road, because the one thing I say is I know Rangers fans are happy right now. You can't rule out Tampa.
Not at all.
And listen, you've been – Rangers fans, you've been in this situation before. You were down 2-0 to Carolina, and you saw what winning two home games did for you. It boosted you back into that series.
Right.
I think it launched you to that Game 7 win. The way they dominated Carolina at home was a huge boost for the morale of the Rangers and for that series. So if Tampa comes in and they sweep at home, it's a brand-new series. So Rangers fans, you have every right to be happy. I'm happy. I'm a Rangers fan.
Absolutely.
Thrilled. I'm over the roof right now.
Right.
But I'm still very cautious. I'm not going to say that this series is over until the Rangers win that fourth game. Obviously, that's an obvious statement, but I think that's just the way you have to treat Tampa.
Absolutely. And the biggest revelation for those playoffs, I feel, has been the kids. The kid line.
You have to talk about the kids. The kids line, but
yeah,
there's one other guy we got to talk about. Keandre Miller. He's the guy that scores the first goal in that game to even it up, right? Tampa scores within like the first 2 minutes. And you're going, oh boy, Tampa showed up to play, and Keandre Miller gets his first shot blocked, takes it back, and beats Vasilevsky glove side. And I mean, it's just huge. And he's been playing; he's such a fantastic defender. His ability as a forward, he's fantastic. You love to see that from Keandre.
The development of Keandre Miller has been absolutely phenomenal to see. But like, just a quick note: we have a quick piece of audio from our beat reporter
Quigs,
Thomas Quigley, who interviewed Gerard Gallant regarding Keandre Miller. Here you go.
Yeah, no, he's been good all year. I mean, he's getting better. You know, every month he got better and better and better, more confidence. And, you know, he plays 24, 25 minutes a night for us. And playing with Jacob Trouba's really helped his game. And, you know, he's a reliable player. And he's a young kid, but he's still playing great hockey for us. So we love him. Love the way he plays.
And I think he's really become, maybe not an elite defenseman, but he's done so much for
this
team.
He's going to be an elite
defenseman. You look at those two defensive pairings, the top two defensive pairings for the Rangers.
So confident.
First off, Fox and Lindgren, who I think complement each other perfectly. They both do different things well. They're a great pairing. Trouba, a hard hitter, and he's paired with the very athletic Keandre Miller. It's a guy that, you know, used to be a forward, I think, in his youth high school days, and that's why you see he's got that speed. He's got great hands. He's going to be a star in this league. And listen, not to put shame on the third defensive line. It's kind of just average. Listen, Braun and
cool
Schneider,
too.
They're
it's
good.
It's a compliment because you got age, experience, and you got young.
Miller and Trouba and Fox and Lindgren are just at a different level. To have those
absolutely.
Two defensive pairings with the way that your top three lines are playing, it's really, the Rangers are in a good spot right now.
Oh, absolutely. And the fact that they're so young, I mean, obviously Braun and Trouba are a little bit older, you know, but they got four really young, under 24 defensemen. You got Braun, Schneider, Fox, Miller, and Lindgren. They're all young. They're all getting their first taste of playoff experience, really, and they're all stepping up to the task. It's really great to see. Lindy, first of all, shout out to Lindgren.
Oh,
the
God.
Guy,
he's
the
warrior.
Warrior, first of all, playoff beard is immaculate. Very messy, but immaculate. The guy is just, as you said, perfect compliment to Fox, because Lindy, more of a defensive guy, sets the tone, and then Foxy can just free roam and do whatever he wants, and it works perfectly. It's so fun to see Fox set up the power play, but set up the offense. It's really nice to see and be confident in the defense. After the first Pittsburgh series, it was a little scary. Obviously, Lindy being out.
No, the defense really struggled in the Pittsburgh series.
Patrick Nemeth.
It stepped up in the Carolina series, but you're still seeing great defense from
them.
Exactly. And another good thing, you know, it's fun to talk about, you know, like the kids and the kind of surprises, but the stars are stepping up, and that's not something you could have said about the Rangers. I mean, there was a point in that Carolina series, especially through the first two games, where you were asking, hey, Mika, time to show up. Kreider, time to show up.
Yep.
Panarin, time to show up. And you feel like, especially Mika and Panarin. Panarin gets that goal in game one, and Mika's just been fantastic, really, ever since game three. Mika's been, he's been my favorite part. I'm going to buy a Mika Zibanejad jersey at some point. When they get a medium back on the team store, I'm getting a Mika jersey, because that's just how awesome he's been. But you need the stars to show up, and that's what they've done. And to go up against the Tampa Bay defense that, again, you're not scared of this defense. They give you the space. it's going to be a big series. I think Panarin's not done scoring. I think you're going to see Kreider score before the series is over. And if I had to bet on it, Mika's not done scoring yet.
Oh, Mika's not done scoring at all. Mika Zibanejad is going to be here for a long while. That being said, the first guy you mentioned, Panarin, repping the jersey right now.
And I have his hair, so it's,
exactly,
it's all good.
Exactly. We got it all for the studio. And then next thing you know, you're going to have a Mika jersey, hopefully. Hey, NHL store, MSG shops, please restock for Lou's sake.
Quick shout out to the Rangers fan zone. I went yesterday, and they got like hockey foosball. They got like a little shooting game.
Yeah.
And they got like former Rangers players. It's free to go in, and you get autographs from Rangers players. It's not even crowded, I guess, because it's like Friday in the afternoon, but Rangers fans, though, check it out. I got a cool little Rangers tattoo. It's
dope. Absolutely. Right. Rangers fans, they're diehard, they're loud. You hear the from the goals.
I was just talking about this with my friend. It's so
best
simple, but
song.
Such a good goal song.
Best goal song. Every time
it really
I see,
gets your eye.
Listen, every time I see it on Twitter when the Rangers score a goal and you click on the like video, you hear that's just goosebumps. It gets you so excited and so hyped. And why I'm confident going into the road games at Tampa. Why? Because I think that Ranger fans travel well. I think you're going to see a lot of blue and white and the Tampa stands. We're going to see a good Rangers crowd.
I do want to talk a little bit about the Oilers-Avalanche. That's the other series happening in the West. We've given a lot of time to the Rangers. I think that this conversation will find a way to tie it back.
Oh, absolutely.
To Oilers-Avalanche, but just a world of difference. I have to say, I knew Colorado was good. I'm still a little surprised with how good their offense is, because listen, Edmonton's got a powerful offense, and Colorado through the first two games has really just completely outmanned them. And now it's a legitimate question. It's a similar thing where Edmonton comes home and it's, can they even up the series? It's a similar parallel to the Tampa Rangers thing. I think this has Avalanche sweep written all over.
I agree. I just don't see it with Edmonton. I was very bearish with Edmonton for the sole reason that they're so top heavy. They remind me of the LA Angels of hockey, where they have
Mike Calamari. I think made a similar comparison on One on One Nightly the other day,
really?
And it's such a good comp
because
they have two
Connor
of the best
McDavid.
Players in the
yeah.
world, and Evander Kane, who's a fantastic player in his own
interesting
right.
player person.
It's so accurate.
Yeah, I mean they got the two best players in hockey, in Connor McDavid, Leon Draisaitl, and then. In the range, I mean, baseball, Trout, Otani. Rest of the team is not very good. I'm not very in on the Oilers. They don't play defense. Their goalie situation is very strange with Koskinen and Mike Smith, who's like 87 years old.
Yeah, it's been a tough series for Mike Smith. It's a tough spot for him. I'm still laughing about the goal he let up in in, I think it was it St. Louis, where the guy threw it from behind the other blue line.
Yeah.
Oh no, I think that was Calgary.
That might have been Calgary.
But that was pretty comical. Listen, it's a tough spot for Mike Smith to be in as a goalie. And again, they're so top heavy, and obviously the Avalanche have Nathan MacKinnon, who makes a pretty strong case for the second best player in the world, right behind Connor McDavid. But
they got a deep team.
They also have the depth, and they've been able to shut down the Oilers' offense. That's not something the Oilers have been able to do. They haven't been able to shut down Colorado at all. Again, Colorado's offense is so explosive. They could score three goals in 2 minutes. They've done it before.
They did it last game. They scored three goals in 2 minutes. They also shut out the Oilers with a backup goalie in Pavel Francouz, which is just weird.
He looked better than
Darcy Kemper.
I think he looked better than Kemper. And
really?
I wouldn't. You think that they probably go back to Kemper if he's okay, but it's good that their backup goalie can come in and step up. And I think you know, the Avalanche obviously have the better goalie in this series. I can't wait to see how both of these series pan out, especially if the Rangers advance. I think the Rangers have a legitimate shot against both of these teams.
Absolutely.
They'd have a much better shot against Edmonton, because I think they'd just destroy Edmonton.
Yeah.
Colorado's going to give them it's tough to stop Colorado's offense. It's a whole different world between Tampa and Colorado. Colorado's offense might be the best in the NHL. So I'd be so curious to see that matchup with Igor Shesterkin and the Colorado offense. But it's something where these West teams, they haven't had to play intense defense, really.
Right. I was about to mention that it's a style thing. It's a stylistic thing. In contrast, I feel like the West is very much more open, more fun, high-scoring, fast-paced. And then the East is very, not congested,
it's
but
almost like
physical.
It's like street ball. It's
yeah,
like
yeah.
It's really all offense, very little defense. I would have been so curious to see if Carolina could have got to the Cup. I would have loved to see a Carolina-Colorado match.
That would have been so
just
weird.
Just to see which would win, because Colorado's offense is good, and I like the Rangers' offense. They're not on the level of Colorado, so I would like to see, could Colorado be able to handle Carolina's forecheck? And maybe that's right. Maybe we'll find out in the coming years.
Yeah.
But it would be really curious. I know that a lot of people are still down the Rangers. They still think they're a little fluky, and they think if they get to the Cup that Colorado's just going to blow them out.
The goalposts move every day.
I got news for you. I think that whether it's the Oilers, and it's probably going to be the Avalanche that advance, but
yes,
whichever team advances, I think they're going to be in for a rude awakening when they have to play one of the teams in the East.
A rude awakening indeed. And I mean, you're predicting sweep? Avalanche sweep over the Oilers?
I think Avalanche sweep Oilers, and that's actually something I've talked about with Sam Bohr. I would love an Avalanche Rangers Stanley
Absolutely.
Cup. It's something I've said since the beginning of these playoffs, and I think that would be such a great series, because again, I think it would be a tough matchup for the Rangers, but I think you'd be really impressed with how well the Rangers would battle against them. I think it'd be fun.
I mean, it's their offense, Colorado's offense, with McKinnon and Rantanen and Kadri.
Don't sleep on Makar. Makar's
a
beast,
too. No. We'll get to Makar in a second. But then versus an unstoppable force in their Colorado offense with Makar coming on like from behind versus an immovable object in Igor Shesterkin and that Rangers defense.
It's going to be fun.
First of all, Rangers got to get past Tampa. But
even if it's the Tampa matchup, that's a fun matchup too, because you have Colorado, this great offense, against a team that's been there,
here.
Done it twice,
yeah.
Trying to do it a third time. That's a good storyline in its own right.
Absolutely. And, you know, this is what we love. We love the Stanley Cup playoffs.
This is why you should all watch hockey.
Everybody,
it's pretty
watch
awesome,
hockey.
Man.
I made the late decision to become a hockey fan over the last 3 years. Best decision
of my
life.
I got news for you. Hockey is becoming my number two sport. It passed football.
Oh, it's climbing.
This playoff cemented it. It's past football.
It's climbing.
Right now, it's above baseball. Not long term, but in this month,
Absolutely. It's rising up those power rankings of sports. And you know what? It's always good to see your team make a deep playoff run. But
it certainly helps.
Yeah, absolutely. But that will do it for our hockey talk real quick. We're going to head into a quick station break before we hear from Miles Grossman with some headlines.
You're listening to One on One, New York's longest running sports call-in show on 90.7 FM, WFUV.org, and WFUVsports.org.
Welcome back to One on One, New York's longest running sports call-in show. I'm Miles Grossman with some headlines for you. And let's turn to the WNBA. On Wednesday, the New York Liberty announced that Bonai Gelani underwent successful arthroscopic partial meniscectomy. A meniscectomy on her right knee.
You nailed it, Miles. That's
exactly.
Yeah.
That's about as close as I was
going to
get.
It's a brutal word.
We were talking about that before.
That's a spelling bee word.
It's a tough injury to say.
But the procedure was performed by Dr. Riley Williams and Dr. Gabriella Ode. Always got to give a shout-out to the surgeons.
You have to.
What a career that is if you are a professional surgeon. So shout-out to the surgeons getting Bonai Gelani right. So Bonai Gelani, one of the stars of the New York Liberty, will be out for approximately 8 weeks, and that is not the only injury that the Liberty have had to deal with. Jocelyn Willoughby had an injection in her right quad the other week, and she'll be out for 6 to 8 weeks. So two starters right off the bat in the recent weeks being taken out of the Liberty's lineup. And this year, the Liberty had some more excitement surrounding them.
Absolutely.
Than they had in the past. A new head coach in Sandy Brondello, the head coach of the Australian national team. Honshu and AD, the 2019 draft class of New York Liberty, finally returning. AD battled a long-haul case of COVID.
Yep.
They are finally back to return, and Honshu is... been out since the start of the COVID-19 pandemic, did not play the wobble season. And then obviously in the offseason, Steph Dolson was signed from Chicago. So all the new talent, along with a new head coach and Sandy Brondello, a head coach with pedigree, should I say, a lot of excitement around the New York Liberty to begin the year. Then on opening night, they get the year started with a win over the shorthanded Connecticut Sun at home. And that excitement just builds. And then immediately following the opening night win, they drop seven straight. And you're thinking, where have we gone? And throughout those seven games, obviously two of your star players, Willoughby, arguably the best defensive player on the New York Liberty, Laney, arguably the best offensive player right there with Sabrina and Howard and everyone else that they have in the mix. But two of your starters, two of your best players undergo procedures that have them out 6 to 8 weeks. And that same time span, you're dropping seven straight games. So it's a tough spot to Liberty, and then following those seven straight losses, two wins, right? You pick up a win at home over the Indiana Fever, the lowly Indiana Fever, I should say, but no one's the lowly when you are a 1-17 to start the year. So following their win at home over the Indiana Fever, they get a win just last night in Washington, D.C. over the Washington Mystics, and Washington is a particularly good offense. They were without their head coach and their number one assistant due to COVID safety protocols. But Washington's a good team. They have a legitimate big three, including Natasha Cloud, such a dynamic score. So the Liberty now back in their winning ways, 3-7 on the year. And there's a reason why there's so much excitement around this Liberty team, right? They're a talented group, and now they've battled some injuries. Lou, it's been an up and down year, right? A lot of things to be excited about, but the consistency hasn't been there. We've seen some games where the Liberty just straight up fall flat on their face. I'm wondering, now that they've won two games in a row, what do the Liberty need to continue doing and to build off of to keep things going and hopefully be the playoff team that they might be at the end of the year?
Well, I think what was the consistent thing in those two games they won is Sabrina Ionescu had fantastic performances, and I think tying it back to that Laney injury, that's an injury that's gonna hurt. You're already an offense that dead last in the WNBA in terms of scoring. You still have the worst plus minus, the only team in negative double digits.
Mm-hmm.
Had to throw that one out to you.
Yeah,
and no, that's really a great stat, and that's really due to the 230 plus point losses they've suffered. So they're a team that absolutely has the potential to get blown out. But continue, my apologies.
I would say that Sabrina's the key, right? I think the tough thing is, she's still super young. We were talking about this, Miles. We're kind of looking at this as her first year last year, still kind of dealing with that ankle injury that she suffered in her rookie year. So this is kind of her first year to find out what do we have in her. And obviously her ceiling, I think, is way high. You see when she booms, it's big. And you look at Liberty, you're 3-1 when she scores 20-plus points, the one loss, and overtime to the Fever. So when she's playing well, the Liberty are playing well. But she's also had some duds. She has two games where she scored 2 points.
Yes.
She has four games where she scored less than 10. And it's one of those things where I think you have to find, you're going to have to allow Ionescu to kind of to go through this and try and find some consistency. You're going to have to look for some role players. So look, I'm looking at Chu. I'm looking at Dolson, and maybe take a bigger step, especially Dolson working in the backcourt with Ionescu. I think that's going to be a big pairing, and you need Natasha Howard to just keep doing what she's doing. She seems to be the most consistent piece on this team right now.
And you mentioned the consistency from Sabrina Ionescu. Surely been an issue throughout the start of the year. She dropped 31 in that overtime loss to the Fever, and that was the first player in the 2022 WNBA season to drop 30-plus. That's particularly rare in the WNBA. It's not like dropping 30 in the NBA. It's kind of like dropping 40 in the WNBA. In the NBA, I'd make that a fair equivalent. So, you know, we surely should hope to see Sabrina grow into the player we know she can be. As Lou, you touched on it, it was just two games into her career with the New York Liberty. She has the ankle injury, and she's sidelined for the remainder of her rookie year. She comes back in her sophomore year last year, has a relatively unproductive year for Sabrina Ionescu standards, recovering from that ankle injury. And now early in this year, Coach Sandy Brondello has touched on this a handful of times. Now, we've seen these duds out of Sabrina, and according to Coach, she's battled a couple. She won't even say what they are, but she says she's had a couple small injuries. She uses the Australian term of niggles, which is pretty funny. No one in the press knew what the term meant.
It was
a big theme throughout. She jokes about it to this day that Sabrina's been battling these minor injuries, and now these last three games, Sabrina's been healthy and she's been performing as we know she can. She's been unbelievable.
Oh, yeah.
And so I definitely do hope to see Sabrina Ionescu kind of. She's someone who can average 20 points a game. That's not an unreal expectation for a player like that. You draft her one overall. You expect her to be the franchise point guard of the future. And now this is her first uninjured, you know, nothing getting in her way season. This is year three now. There's some pressure that you should grow at this point. Now she's battled a little bit of the injuries even early on in this same season, but I don't expect that to continue. I think Sabrina is someone who will end up averaging 20 points a game in the WNBA, which is very rare. And the issue was, for me, obviously without Laney and without Willoughby, this team lost a lot of their weapons. And when you're losing seven games and you're without your two weapons, you need someone to step up. And it seemed like when the Liberty were getting blown out in that seven-game stretch, it seemed that they weren't able to keep up with their opponents when it comes to speed, when it comes to defensive intensity, and just staying a step ahead of your opponent. And a lot of that has changed over the last three games, and a big part of that is Rebecca Allen. Rebecca Allen, she's in her fifth year with the Liberty now. She joined the Liberty late this year. She's Australian, same as Sandy Brondello, but she joined Liberty late into this year due to an overseas commitment with Valencia in Spain. Rebecca Allen is a truly talented player. 6'2", super lanky, super long wingspan. And she's clearly been pivotal for the Liberty over the last couple games. You know, she's having a career year, but I would say it's almost the things that don't show up on the stat sheet that's made her year so special so far. She's made the Liberty from during those five games that we were without her and we were losing game after game after game. It seemed like their offense was stagnant, and it seemed like we were a step slow. Now that Rebecca Allen has returned, the ball is flowing, and on defense, she provides a level of speed that they haven't had. So I'm really looking forward to that. And touching on that issue of speed once again, the addition of Crystal Dangerfield has been huge because Sabrina Ionescu was forced to run point guard mainly, and as we know, she's a bit of a combo two guard. And so the Liberty are now finally getting the most productive minutes out of Sabrina by having Crystal Dangerfield at the starting point guard. Dangerfield was someone who had spent some time with the Lynx. She was waived and signed a hardship deal, and she's still with the New York Liberty. And I see her really solidifying her role as the starting point guard on this team, even as a free agent, which is rare. And Tyler, I'll turn it to you now. I'll stop my Liberty spiel. I know that was long. But for you, you see these two wins now, and then Crystal Dangerfield, Rebecca Allen, they're there, they're making an impact, and it seems that Rebecca Allen, Ionescu, and Dangerfield play together really smoothly. Do you see the New York Liberty as a potential playoff team, even with the long-term injuries of Willoughby and Laney, or is this going to be a year where they take a step back and don't end up making the top eight?
I mean, it's still early to say, I will say. It's still very early in the season. We're only 10 games in for the Liberty. Health is such a big problem. Obviously, Jocelyn Willoughby getting hurt. She is one of the better defenders on this team.
Definitely.
But Nigel Laney, the third leading scorer, and just a very good presence she can play. She can pass the ball. She's averaged 4.3 assists, 3.8 rebounds. She brings like a little bit of an all-around offensive presence.
Mm-hmm.
But you mentioned, Crystal Dangerfield running the point.
Yeah.
If it lets Ionescu do her thing and free roam and kind of gives her the keys to the offense from a secondary creator point of view, where she can attack and just kill, that's going to open up that offense so much more. Where Sabrina doesn't have to hold on to the reins of being the playmaker and doing literally everything. Because Sabrina, to me, is the engine of this Liberty team.
She is.
She's, first of all, the most well-marketed player. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows Sabrina Ionescu from her time at Oregon, being the first overall pick in the WNBA draft in 2020, to being like just she had like a game winner last year, I believe.
Yeah.
Had a couple of great performances. And the last two games, she's looked really good. I mean, she's 23 and 24 points, respectively. Pretty efficient. Made 5 of 10 three-pointers last game.
And those three-pointers, you see her pulling up from 35.
She's got range.
34 feet. Yesterday, she hit one from 34.
Really?
She's confidently.
Yeah.
I can confidently say that she's the only player in the WNBA where she takes a 34-foot three-pointer
and
you're content.
It's not a bad shot.
And you don't cringe at the sight of that shot, because that's rare. That shooting ability where you're at the logo in the WNBA, given it is a slightly smaller ball, but you rarely see anyone pulling up from that range, and then if you do, you'd say that's an ill-advised shot. She's the only player where you can justify taking that bold 34-footer.
Like it's Sabrina. Like it's okay. She's got that range. She practices that shot.
Yeah.
But having Sabrina, giving her like more of a green light, like she already has the green light, obviously, but like giving her less responsibility to be the primary offensive creator, mm-hmm. bringing the ball up, setting up the offense, initiating. It makes her job easier. She's going to be more efficient. Obviously, Natasha Howard, we talked about, she's a little bit more consistent. But Natasha Howard also having, I guess, less responsibility, having somebody to actually set her up with Crystal Dangerfield running the offense is going to be huge. It's going to pay massive dividends to this Liberty team.
I want to ask real quick, because you were talking about the defense. Is this Liberty team a team that can outscore people, or are they going to need that defense if they want to win basketball games?
Absolutely. I think it's going to take a solid defensive effort because while they do have a lot of weapons, that's not going to get it done for you in this league. And,
right.
You know,
it's a team game.
Exactly. And it seemed that, you know, during that losing streak, speed was the issue. They were a step behind. It seemed that they weren't able to make their switches quick enough. The foul trouble was an issue during this losing streak for a lot of their starters, because they would get behind on their rotations and then close out on a shooter or a driver late, and then they'd obviously get the foul call. That was an issue in particular with Steph Dolson. You know, she's a big body in the post, but she's not necessarily the quickest. She doesn't necessarily have the best movement to her on either side of the ball.
Right.
So that was definitely an issue. But now that, you know, the beginning of that losing streak was without Rebecca Allen.
Mm-hmm. She's a big part now.
Exactly. And without Dangerfield. And so now that you have, those are two of the quickest players on the Liberty, and they were just straight up not on the squad even just a couple of weeks ago. So I think that, you know, Dangerfield bringing the ball up, who can, you know, she's speedy, she can drive in and kick, and she's also very quick on the defensive end. So the movement of the Liberty is something that has changed so quickly in the past couple of weeks, and it's improved a lot. And that was the issue last year when the Liberty were really looking poor in the second half of the year before they kind of went on their run to secure that eight seed. They were a stagnant offense. It was simple as that. They were not moving the ball very well, and it was not a very productive offense because of that. And even with a relatively solid defense last year, the offense wasn't there because of the lack of speed and movement. Now that the speed and movement seems to be picking up, this is a 3-7 team. Mm-hmm. It's super early in the year, but it's a team that can absolutely make the playoffs in my mind. They could get near 500 ball by the end of the year. And in my mind, if they're near 500 ball and then Willoughby and Laney are coming back around playoff time, the Liberty absolutely have potential. And there's reasons why there was so much more excitement this year than in past years. It's a head coach with pedigree. It's a system that really has a lot of potential. Cohesiveness has surely been an issue early on. But the New York Liberty are something to be excited about, and it's really finally coming together with these two back-to-back wins. They'll have a two-game set at home in Barclays tomorrow at 2 p.m. matinee against the Lynx, and then Tuesday night back in action against the Lynx again. So these are two important games against the lowly Lynx, and the Liberty have a potential to really position themselves well here following these two games.
Absolutely. They got to take care of these next three games. But definitely, I think the Liberty are in a good position. But thank you again, Miles, for our WNBA talk with the headlines. That'll do it for our WNBA headlines. We're going to head into a quick break, and when we come back, we'll have an interview with the New York Post's beat reporter, Mark Berman.
Hey everyone, it's Ryan Gregoire, beat reporter on the New York Yankees for WFUV Sports. You can find all my coverage on our social media platforms, including post-game reports, special features, and everything Yankees. WFUV Sports, your home for New York Yankees coverage all season long.
One-on-one, New York's longest-running sports call-in show. Along with Thomas Aiello, I'm Colin Lochran, and we're thrilled to be joined by the New York Post Knicks beat writer, Mark Berman. Mark, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great, Thomas and Colin. Thanks so much for inviting me on.
It's great to have you. And, you know, of course, the Knicks season has been over for quite a while, but that hasn't stopped them from making some headlines. Recently, it was reported that they're hiring Jalen Brunson's father, Rick, as an assistant coach. I have to ask, with Jalen entering free agency, should Knicks fans feel somewhat more confident about potentially having him come to the Big Apple?
I'll be honest, I wouldn't read that much into it. You know, we've been writing about Rick Brunson joining Tom for a while, back even a couple of years ago. So this has been in the works. And Rick has told people that he didn't want to join the Knicks staff until his son got his big contract, because his first 4 years he was making minimum wage. Whether this convinces Jalen to play for the Knicks, I'm not sure. I mean, they've had a very complicated relationship. I mean, they're very close, but Rick Brunson has been so hard on his son across the years. He's really guided his basketball career very hands-on. And I wonder if he'd want to actually be in an organization where he'd be traveling with his father. I mean, maybe. I don't know. I just know that Tom Thibodeau is delighted to have his former assistant coach, Rick Brunson, on his staff. Had him in Chicago, had him in Minnesota, was an assistant coach with the Knicks when Rick was there. They go way back. So, you know, Tom Thibodeau has not always had his choice of assistant coaches. William Wesley, who's one of the senior executives, hired Johnny Bryan as an assistant coach. He hired Mike Woodson, and he hired Kenny Payne. And Tom Thibodeau really didn't know those guys. So it's a good move for Tom. Fingers crossed that Jalen wants to be around his father quite a bit.
So, Mark, sticking on the topic of the Knicks, of course, Tom Thibodeau and the team this year, they took a step back from the season prior, of course, making the playoffs. This year they're going 37-45. They're back in the draft lottery, and there's a lot of mishmash talk about what they're going to do with pick 11. Are they going to trade up? Are they going to get rid of the pick completely for a star player? Who's on the roster now that's going to move? What, in your perspective and your mind, could be a realistic draft day scenario for the Knicks as we approach that special night?
Yeah, I think everything's on the table, including trading it all together. If they could get like a real solid player for the rotation, like a starter, a solid starter. But more realistically, they love Jaden Ivey. I've heard that for months. They were able, as I reported, to interview him in Chicago, even though he's out of their range. But he's a CAA guy. So Leon Rose has all those connections, and maybe they'll even work Jaden out. Moving up, they probably have to get up to 5, maybe even 4. I mean, there's even talk about the Rockets liking him at 3, but I think that's a smokescreen. But, yeah, they love Ivory as a combo guard. He's the type of guard that, you know, he gets in the lane and he draws double teams and starts the offense that way. That's what the Knicks are looking for. Kemba Walker was not that player, and Derrick Rose was injured almost the whole year. They need a point guard that could get into the lane and draw attention and pass it out to open shooters. You know, Alec Burks is obviously not that type of point guard. In the 11 range, there's some really good players. Johnny Davis is a good two-way shooting guard. He's got improved from three-point range, and he's looking good in some workouts. And then there's that Jeremy Sochan from Baylor, who's a terrific defender. But the biggest guy that's popped on the radar screen is that Dyson Daniels, who played in the G League Ignite, skipped college, and he's a 6'8 point guard. I mean, some people don't see him as a point guard, but the G League Ignite coaching staff made him the point guard, showed he can pass, showed he can ball handle, needs to be a little better, but he's a very good defender, and he's got to improve his three-point shooting. But if Dyson Daniels could fall to 11, you know, I think the Knicks would be very happy.
As Thomas alluded to, the last 2 years or so for the Knicks have really been quite the journey. I'm wondering, as someone who's followed the team closely, what can you say regarding the job Coach Tom Thibodeau has done during his Knicks tenure?
Listen, he won Coach of the Year, and he probably didn't deserve it over Monty Williams that particular season, but he edged out Monty because that roster was fairly mediocre. Listen, they went into that season with Las Vegas predicting them for like 22 victories. So they really overachieved. He got Julius Randle to play way over his head, and he got RJ going on the right track, and he got a great season from Derrick Rose after Tom, you know, urged management to trade for him. So his first season was spectacular, but then all the flack he took for his second season, when the team kind of came back to earth, I think it really showed that they played over their heads and overachieved in that first year. And I don't think he deserved all that criticism, although I would have liked to see him be a little less stubborn. I think he gave Randle too much leash. I think he needed to hold Randle accountable more. And I think he could have, Obi, that his teammates love him. And I know Tom was concerned about his defense, his team defense, but he brings a spirit to the club. And down the stretch of the season, Tom finally got won over. It was a little too late, but he got won over by Obi Toppin's intangibles, that when he's on the court, everyone seems to pick up their game, pick up their spirit. They run the floor better. They pass more. With Julius Randle, the team sort of bogged down. And that's the big issue now that Tom Thibodeau has to figure out. If they don't make a trade with Randle, how do you play Randle and Obi Toppin together? As they're both power forwards, they're not very versatile. Neither is a five and neither is a three. So that's the big challenge. Do they go 4 and 5 small ball? Tom doesn't like that defensively. It's a tough challenge, but Tom is very stubborn. And that's what ticked off a lot of fans. And he would not play more of the younger players like Miles McBride. That baffled me. Good defender, point guard, good distributor. He had a team first mentality, but he didn't get any minutes. He wanted Alec Burks on the court, and it frustrated the fan base and it frustrated me.
So you bring up, Mark, the older players playing over the younger players. And I wanted to hit on this because this is something that a lot of Knick fans on social media and ones that I've talked to in real life have kind of thought of. Do you think that in order for the Knicks to get better and for Tom Thibodeau to really play these younger players that the Knicks are giving him, right? Do you think that they have to be forcibly taken away from him, almost as if you're taking candy away from a baby? I know that's an insane analogy to use, but could that be a possibility for this team with guys like Randle, Alec Burks, Evan Fournier, maybe Taj Gibson, I guess, could be in that mix? Do you think that's a possibility? And do you think that would create a lot of friction between Rose and Thibodeau?
You make a good point. I think the Knicks would like to trade Alec Burks and get a young asset, even if it's draft picks, even if it's a trade exception, just so Thibodeau doesn't dare play him at point guard again next season. Taj Gibson, he loves, but after the All-Star break, he agreed with management. I don't know if he did it, how reluctantly he did it, but he played the rookie center, Jericho Sims, after the All-Star break, and they got a good look at him, and they got a good impression that he could be a rotation player in this league. So, yeah, he has to be forced into it a little bit, and maybe you got to trade a Burks. even traded Derrick Rose. But Tom loves his veterans. And, you know, he knew he had to save his job, though. And because, as we reported at the All-Star break, there were at least two front office members who thought Tom had lost the team and thought he should be fired. And that could still happen if the Knicks get off to a lousy start this season. There's a lot of speculation that Johnny Bryant, the assistant coach, is being groomed as Tom Thibodeau's successor. He's a young assistant that the Jazz had for many years and obviously knows Donovan Mitchell very well. So that could be a drawing card if Johnny Bryant ever became the head coach.
The Knicks might unfortunately be out of it, but there's still NBA Finals games to be played. The Golden State Warriors and Boston Celtics, of course, gave us a great Game 1 matchup with the C's taking home the W. I'm wondering, did you see anything in Game 1 that surprised you?
I mean, I counted the Celtics out. It was the fourth quarter, double digits. I was ready to go to sleep. But I think Draymond Green made a little comment like, you know, they went like whatever 19 for 24 from 3-point range. We're pretty sure that's not going to happen again. Well, that was his insinuation. But this is a savvy team that has nine lives, best team since January in the league. Most scouts will agree. They don't give up. They have a lot of heart, even though they had no finals experience. Al Horford is just a grimy veteran who you just, you know, he's a winner, and he won a national championship, at least one at Florida. So, you know, there are some winning players. I think Jason Tatum is a winning player, and Jaylen Brown is a winning player, even though they never got all the way to the finals. So, yeah, it was surprising to see Boston light it up for the three-point range in that fourth quarter on the road. And kind of after the first quarter, Curry wasn't spectacular. Boston just continues to amaze me. And to steal one in San Francisco was huge, because I'm telling you, San Francisco is a loud arena. It's one of the loudest in the league. Boston is arguably the loudest arena in the NBA in the playoffs. They have great fans and a great tradition, and now they're going to have home court advantage. And they have a lot of heart. And Emi Udoka, who interviewed for the Knicks job once, should have won Coach of the Year in retrospect, obviously, with Monty Williams right now golfing.
So, Mark, I want to touch on some more NBA Finals stuff, but in terms of the media, obviously there's no Mike Breen, there's no Jeff Van Gundy due to COVID, so it's Mark Jones and Mark Jackson running the show for the time being. Do you think that there's a little bit of a different feel maybe to how these finals are being called, or do you think that Mark Jones is doing as good of a job, and or almost in the way that Breen would do the job that he's been doing for the last 20-something years? Do you think that there's a little change in there or no?
I do. I even felt it in Game 7 of Miami-Boston when Mike Breen was out with COVID also. Jeff was there, but Jeff had a – and I wrote this about – you know, Jeff had a sore throat. You could hear his hoarse throat, and Mike wasn't there. And Mark Jackson just didn't seem that excited for a Game 7, I'll be honest. It seemed like he was going through the motions. So last night, yeah, it just didn't have the gravitas that an NBA Finals should have without Mike Breen and Jeff Van Gundy. I think the problem is that there's such a great chemistry between Mike, Jeff, and Mark that even though, you know, the substitutes are okay, they just don't have that same humor and that same back and forth, and I missed it. And this would have been their 14th season doing it. Let's hope that Mike is back. He's had COVID now for over a week. Jeff may be out Game 2 Sunday, but I would love to see those three guys together again, at least when they go back to Boston.
We're certainly hoping they get back soon as well. They've, of course, been the soundtrack for this playoffs in a lot of ways. And, you know, one of the big storylines has been the Celtics defense. They've consistently stifled teams' offensive production every step of the way. Do you think a team like that could be successful in the 80s and 90s style ball when proactive defense was more common?
Right. They're sort of a throwback team right now. You know, this is supposedly the three-point era. But now the Celtics are, you know, starting this trend. And we heard it at the Chicago Combine, where all these prospects were kind of talking about how they're versatile defenders and they can switch one to five. They could guard all five positions. That's like the new vogue term, because that's what Boston does. They switch on every pick and roll because they have players like Marcus Smart who could guard centers. Like, if you remember years ago when Porzingis was on the Knicks, that was a big problem area. Porzingis was always stifled by Marcus Smart, somehow getting under him and giving him a tough physical battle. And now Marcus won Defensive Player of the Year, and he's leading this Celtics defense along with Horford. But Jaylen Brown is a terrific defender. Tatum is an underrated defender. Right down the line, Grant Williams, obviously, a solid defender. Yes, defense is ruling the roost. Miami also makes the conference finals. And everyone talked about the three-point revolution, and there's been books written about it. But Boston's defense has stolen the show during this spring run to the championship round.
So staying on the topic of Boston, they were a team at the beginning of the year that, and I'm going to humiliate myself for this, I had written them off, not even getting in the playoff or the play-in tournament, excuse me. And now here they are in the NBA finals. What do you think at any point in the season was the moment where Boston management and the coaches and the players said, we're going to flip it right now? Where do you think that started?
Maybe when the Knicks beat them three times. I think the Knicks were 3-1. Fournier played out of his mind. It was one night Kemba came and rescued the Knicks. And then opening night, double overtime victory and a thriller. And yeah, so the Celtics are coming off a mediocre season last year, where they were knocked down in the first round by the Nets. And the first thing about 1 year ago, Brad Stevens was promoted to president, and I think the next day he traded Kemba Walker, attached an asset, got back Al Horford, who people thought may have been over the hill, and they decided not to re-sign Evan Fournier, and that worked out. But in the middle of the season, Udoka finally really got the defensive message across to them. They were, you know, two games under 500 at some point in December. So things finally clicked. They finally bought into the rookie coach's message. And he's been a terrific. Listen, Udoka was also an assistant with the Nets and interviewed with the Knicks. So that either both teams could have had him as their head coach. He's become a terrific head coach. And the Celtics, listen, one scout said if the Celtics win the title, it's the worst Celtics team to ever win the championship. But they'll take it. They'll take it number 18.
Definitely interesting in Boston with everything that's happened this year. The Western side of things in this finals is also fascinating because with this season's appearance, the Warriors have now made six finals in the last 8 years. It begs the question, Mark, does Golden State have a claim to being one of the NBA's greatest dynasties?
Yeah, I mean, it's a dynasty now. To go 2 years without making the playoffs and then back in the finals after that tremendous run, and to do it with Durant, without Durant, it's really a great dynasty that Steve Kerr has put together. One of the greatest. I mean, it's probably a top five. Let's see how they fare now. I mean, if they win the championship, we might be talking a little loftier in the greatest teams of all time. But the three mainstays, Klay Thompson, Draymond Green, and Steph Curry, are still there, even though Klay Thompson is a little diminished. I mean, he's just not the same star that he was when they were winning the titles. Even defensively, scouts say he's just not, doesn't have the same pep and bounce after all those knee surgeries. But, you know, he's still solid and still can shoot from three. Steve Kerr is a wonderful coach. Again, I hate to bring up the Knicks name again, but he had verbally agreed to be the head coach of the New York Knicks with Phil Jackson. But then he met with the Warriors after the Warriors got bounced in the first round, and they fired Mark Jackson immediately. And he met with ownership and just loved his time with hanging out with the new Warriors owners. And he realized Dolan's reputation, and he asked his buddy Phil Jackson if he could renege on his verbal agreement. And Phil Jackson, you know, it's debatable what Phil should have done, but he says, Steve, go with where your heart takes you. And the rest is history. The rest is a dynasty created by Steve Kerr's magical touch. He's a great guy and a great coach.
I want to switch over back to the NBA draft a little bit. Of course, we talk about the huge names like Ivy and Banchero and Chet Holmgren and this one and that one. But I want to switch to those second round later picks, because some good players can come out of there, role players, maybe even an all-star if you get lucky, maybe even MVPs if you get really, really lucky like the Nuggets do. Who do you like in that very late area of the draft this year for any team in the NBA? Give me two guys that you really like.
Well, the Knicks, I guess they picked 41 or 42. I can't remember which one. And there is a Gonzaga sharpshooter that I saw at the Chicago Combine. It might be Holmberg.
Oh, Ryan Nemhard.
Oh, Nemhard. Yeah, that's his name. Yeah, I saw him. Great shooter. And I feel the Knicks need shooting. And he hasn't worked out yet, but I think he will. And keep an eye on that name. You know, the Knicks have had a few guys we've talked to recently in the last few days go through Tarrytown, including a local kid, Tyson Etienne from Wichita State. Probably pronounced his name wrong, but his father played at Maryland. His godfather is Marcus Camby, and he's a point guard who may have fallen off. I think if he came out last year, he would have been a early second round pick, but he decided to stay in the draft, and now he's more later second round. But I know the Knicks like him. And then there's Orlando Johnson from Fresno State, 6'11", versatile defender. We got a chance to talk to him in Tarrytown. Another player to keep your eye on. The Knicks love, want to become more versatile defensively. I wrote that Thibodeau doesn't like to switch that much with this team because he didn't feel the roster was capable of. He didn't want to switch with Mitchell Robinson because he liked Mitchell guarding the interior. He didn't want him out on the perimeter guarding a 6'2" player because it was kind of wasting him. So, but they would like more versatile defenders, and maybe they could add one in the second round.
Just one final question for you, and it has something to do with the shape or structure of the association. Recently, NBA Commissioner Adam Silver said that he's not completely against changing the format or shortening the season if it would reduce injuries. Would you say that shortening the season is a solid idea or something the NBA should look into?
Oh, 100%. 82 games, and then this ridiculous two-month postseason that has dragged on and on and on. The play-in situation is bogus. There's no way that it should be that lengthy and that complicated and that involved. If you want to add a little spice, do the 8-9 teams, have them have a best of a one-game playoff, and the ninth seed has to win two games. But the way he's structured it, with the 7 through 10 is just a nightmare. The fans, I feel, have tired out. It's been the regular season ended 2 months ago, April 10th. There's no way that a postseason should last over 2 months, which it has gone. We'll go over 2 months once they get into the middle of the finals. So shorten the regular season to 70 games. I'd love to see that and get rid of the play-in stuff. And I think we have a more attractive product. Naturally, it's all about revenue with Adam Silver milking every single dollar he can milk so these players can make $200 million contracts and not even be a superstar. So that's what it's about. It's about revenue. It's about the TV deals, wanting more games, more commercials, more money. But for the fans, I think some fans are tuckered out. I mean, it was a great game one, but going into the finals, I didn't feel the same buzz that I usually feel going into the NBA finals. And I think it's because of the endless postseason.
Mark, thank you so much for joining us on the show. We appreciate the time very much. Everyone, stay tuned to One-on-One, New York's longest-running sports call-in show.
Welcome back to One-on-One, New York's longest-running sports call-in show. Thank you again to Mark Berman for joining the show. We're going to end today's show with a little fun segment, a little fun discussion, as we've entered June, which should be a fair benchmark for the MLB season so far. We've taken a page out of the book of John Boy Media's Talking Baseball podcast. Great podcast, by the way, where John Boy, Talking Jake, and Trevor Plouffe discussed their May All-Star team so far. We're going to discuss through the season so far. Lou and I were talking about our AL and NL All-Star teams to date. But beforehand, we're going to send it over to Lou for the trivia question and some Yankee news.
Yeah, man. The trivia question, as of now, still unanswered. So if you want those two free Yankees
tickets.
August 2nd Seattle Mariners game versus the New York Yankees, get a chance to see Julio Rodriguez. Come on. That question again, what did Derek Jeter accomplish for the first time in baseball history in 2000? DM our Twitter, WFUV Sports. Be the first to DM with the correct answer. You get those free tickets. That sounds like a pretty good deal to me, man.
I agree. Pretty fair deal. But you also have some Yankee news to break.
I do. Well, let's start first things first. Aaron Judge, leadoff home run. His 21st of the year. The Yankees are up 1-0. Giancarlo Stanton with a 412-foot double.
Almost
his first at-bat back from the injury, so that's cool. And according to Hector Gomez, and he's been a little hit or miss with the insider info that he brings, according to him, Miguel Andujar told Aaron Boone that he no longer wants to be a Yankee. He's requesting a trade. That's according to Hector Gomez. And that, before we get into this segment, I just want to say, you know, you talked about having depth, that you can't have too much of a good thing. It's a good problem to have.
And
sometimes it's not. When you have a guy that deserves to be a starter and is talented enough to be a starter in the MLB, and you're sending him down to the minor leagues, that's an issue. And the tough thing I would have with this is, like, look me in the eyes and tell me that Andujar is not better than Marwin Gonzalez or Aaron Hicks right now. And, you know, you could make the argument for Joey Gallo. I get that. But it's tough for me to say, yeah, we're just going to get rid of Andujar because we're sticking with a depth guy when this guy deserves to be in the MLB. That's all I'm saying.
Listen, I fully agree, and I wish the best for Andujar.
Ken Rosenthal confirmed it, so that's huge.
Now we're in the clear.
Thank you, Ralph. Huge shout out to our producer, Ralph Aberry, who, by the way, awesome tunes in the break. I mean, that's
phenomenal.
The music in the break, that's a huge part of setting the tone, and throughout the show, he's been doing some groovy tones. So
Smooth sailing the whole show. Ralph's done a great job. Shout out to Ralph. But let's go to the more of a positive tone. Let's talk about good players and all-star, like the all-star team so far. I mean, we've seen some great players in the MLB this year. We're going to start off with a position that's kind of like a little bit weaker. We're going to start off with the catcher, the backstop, one of the most important positions in baseball. And it's been kind of hot and cold, but who's your AL and NL catcher right now for the all-star teams?
The funny thing is that realistically, there's like only one guy that deserves to make the all-star team as a catcher. It's the NL. It's Wilson Contreras.
Yes.
He's got a 931 OPS right now. He's killing it. Mm-hmm. With Chicago, one of the few people that is, unfortunately, for them. In the AL, it's tough. Right now, I'm looking at Jonah Heim.
I agree.
Stepped into the starting role with Texas. I think he's tied for the AL home run lead for catchers with 6. Mm-hmm. 805 OPS, 135 weighted runs created plus. However, I'm going to be voting for Jose Trevino.
Oh, I fully agree.
And really, there's a little bit of a gap with the play appearance again. He's only at 89, but once he gets over 100, I think his stats start to get legit. Mm-hmm. And you know, we were talking about his stats a little bit earlier. He's hitting 289 with an 819 OPS, a 139 weighted runs created plus. That is, those are the best in the AL. So,
and his defense is ridiculous.
Right now, it's time for me, but you give me 2 weeks, I think there's enough of a sample size to say that Trevino legitimately deserves to be an all-star catcher.
Fully agreed. I mean, there's a couple of guys, I guess. Heim, Trevino.
Alejandro Kirk. AL is definitely in the conversation.
Right. Danny
Jansen's
missing a lot of plate appearances, but he's got 7 home runs.
It was a throw-up for me between Kirk and Heim right now. Right. I went with Heim because it feels like not only is he the better story, I think his offensive numbers are better.
Right, I fully agree. I went with Jonah Heim too.
But NL is, it's Contreras. I mean, Varsho's having a good...
Varsho's good, but he might be a backup.
He plays outfield too. He plays in center field.
No, Dalton Varsho's a great player. I think he'll get in as I guess the Diamondbacks representative and like maybe a backup catcher, but he's great, but it's Contreras.
Tyler Stevenson quietly having a good year for Cincinnati. Don't know if it's enough for him to make the All-Star game, but quietly becoming a top 10 catcher in the league.
Fair enough. I respect that. Stevenson's a good player. First base. We have the clearer verdict than the NL, but AL also pretty clear.
I think that this is... Probably in both chalk. Ways, this is pretty easy. It's Ty France and it's Paul Goldschmidt.
Oh, easily.
I think NL is tough because Goldschmidt's the stats are better, but you can make an argument for Pete Alonso. CJ Cron also, like, Alonso and Cron are going to make the All-Star team no matter what.
Absolutely.
Ty France is running away with AL first base numbers kind of low.
Rizzo falling off after that great start. Rizzo would have given him a run for his money, but Rizzo's kind of fallen off. Not a cliff, but he's starting to pick it back up. But right now, it's clearly Ty France.
It's so, like, you think at first base, that's a big offensive production position. Only 3 first basemen in the league with 100 plate appearances have an OPS above 900. Like, you feel like that number would be a little bit bigger. It's Goldschmidt, France, and Cron.
Right.
And Pete Alonso, surprisingly, the OPS is at like 882. But I mean, he's gonna be an All-Star. He's having a fantastic year with the Mets.
Yeah, it's polar bear Pete.
I think for starting first baseman though, it's pretty clear cut. It's France and Alonso. France and Goldschmidt.
France and Goldie have the runaway vote for me. Goldie's
real quick though.
Yeah, go ahead.
Luis Arraez, another guy quietly having a great year.
Don't know how his on base percentage is higher than a slugging.
Playing
which makes me
first
laugh.
Base for the Minnesota Twins, I think with Miguel Sano out, always a good contact guy. But Luis Arraez currently hitting .342.
Arraez is a good player. I will say.
I think that's a sneaky. He's having a sneaky bid for All-Star.
Definitely off the bench, but for me, yeah, it's France and Goldschmidt. Second base. Second base was tough for me. I mean, I went to couple directions with this one. I feel like the NL is pretty clear to me.
I'm curious to see who you went with in the NL.
Oh, in the NL? Should I start with AL or NL? I'll start with NL.
I think we can do whatever we want, and I want you to start with the NL.
Let's do it. Jazz Chisholm. You like Jazz? Exactly.
I think it's Jazz. You look at the season.
Who do you think?
I think it's Jazz. Look at the season that he's having, there's an argument to be made for Jeff McNeil.
We'll wait on that. Jeff McNeil.
Luis
Guillorme,
technically a second baseman. If you want to write him in, again, he's hitting .360, so that's
Mets
cool.
Mets fans are voting Guillorme.
But right now, it's Jazz Chisholm. He's been at the forefront of the league for a while, just his personality as a player, but now his play really starting to elevate to the point where we're starting to talk about him as a superstar, and that's cool.
Yeah, and he's so marketable, man. Jazz Chisholm's just a great guy. My AL pick. Who's your AL pick? I want to hear yours.
It's Altuve, man.
Yeah, it's Altuve.
It's Altuve. It's pretty clear cut.
I wanted to pick Glaber. I was very close to picking Glaber.
And this is something that surprised me. Glaber, 10 home runs, tied for, I believe, the lead league for home runs among second basemen. Any AL players that have more than 10?
Let me check. He leads that outright, yeah.
So he's tied with Altuve, right? Him and Altuve both have 10 home runs. So, you know, it's crazy to think about Glaber being kind of in the same conversation as Altuve. And again, Glaber, a guy that I believe 2-time All-Star 2018, 2019.
Yeah, he was.
A guy that really had a great couple of years, and then we talked about the decline in 2020, 2021.
Mm-hmm. He's finding his form again.
He's kind of back.
He's kind of back.
He's finding his power stroke. Again,
he would really have to
go on a tear at this point to catch up to Altuve.
I think he has a sleeper chance to make it as a reserve.
Well, I think that there are probably still people that don't like Jose Altuve and the Astros.
Yeah.
And because of that, Jose Altuve might get robbed of votes. Altuve deserves to be the starting second baseman.
He's the best second baseman.
If Gleyber becomes the starting second baseman, am I going to complain? Absolutely not.
Absolutely not. I would love to see Gleyber in at the second base position, but shortstop is a tough one. We're going to go to shortstop. The AL one was tough, so we'll start off with the NL one because I feel like the NL one is weird, but
it's a
little
easier.
We're
going to be on the same page.
Yeah, NL, you want to get yours off?
I went with Trey Turner. I had Lindor for a little bit. And then I looked at the stats, and Turner's got Lindor beat in basically every statistic. He's on like a 25-game hit streak.
Yeah.
He's killing it.
I see that.
You look at Lindor's number. He got off to a great start. He's kind of cooled off just enough where his numbers are still good, but Turner's got him beat in just every single offensive category.
Yeah. I'm going to be honest. I picked Lindor. I think Lindor's
coming. That's because you're a fraud.
No, I forgot. I didn't look at Trey Turner's like
you
that
just you
in
didn't
depth.
Look at the best shortstop in the NL.
I was looking at Fangraphs. You know, Lindor has been beat on WAR. I just think that Lindor is. I mean, Trey Turner's obviously on 25-20 whatever hit streak 25-26. I don't know if it's still active. He's been ridiculous. I took Lindor because
there's a 50-point gap in the OPS.
That is fair. That is fair.
It's kind of huge.
I'm sure Trey Turner's been the better player. I just think that Lindor's
it's
had some.
It's okay for you to pick
Lindor's
Lindor.
Lindor's had some huge hits.
I'm just saying that you're
wrong. Oh, fair enough. You know, Lindor had he's had some huge moments. What do you call it? And plus, Mets fans are going to vote him in. Sure, the Dodgers have a massive fan base.
I think the Dodgers fans are going to get Turner in, to be honest with you.
The Dodgers have enough All-Stars. Let's give Lindor the shot. I'll give Lindor
do
the shot.
Do they have enough All-Stars?
They do. Pitching?
In
yeah.
In
they'll get their guys.
I only have two for them right now.
What? Oh, Mookie's the obvious
I know
one.
They're Dodgers. I know their pitchers are good. I don't want to spoil this. I don't have any Dodgers pitchers on my team right now.
All right. Do it. We'll get to that
I don't
want to
spoil that.
No, we'll get to that later. But let's go to the hot corner real quick. Hot corner. This is tough.
This is the position where it's clear cut to me.
It's clear cut, but it also isn't.
No, there are good position. I think there are good position battles. There have been a lot of good third basemen, but if you're telling me that the starting third baseman in the AL and the NL aren't Jose
Ramirez
and
Manny Machado, yeah, it's clear.
It's kind of the stats just back it up.
Definitely.
Listen, now Rafael Devers having a great year.
That's
he's going to be an All Star.
Yes.
And then Nolan Arenado also having a good year, but
also going to be an All Star.
Jose Ramirez kind of has the best stats in the American League.
He's ridiculous. He leads the league in RBIs. He leads the league in RBIs. Well, leads both leagues in RBIs. Leads the AL in WAR, I believe. 13 home runs, .632 slugging percentage. He's ridiculous. Like, frankly, he's so good.
He's in the MVP conversation
absolutely.
With Judge right now.
The only problem is his team isn't that good, but man.
It's not going to matter if he keeps hitting like this.
You're right. It's not a team award. I'm forgetting that like guys like Trout have won the MVP. It's an individual award. Joe Ram is ridiculous. He's a top 10 player in baseball easily. He is a stud.
At this point, you could say the same thing about Manny Machado, and I feel like we've been kind of sleeping on Machado. I feel like ever since he's been to San Diego, he's not getting the same amount of hype as he got when he was at Baltimore, which is weird to say.
Right, he's under the radar of Tatis, I guess, and everybody knows Tatis. But Machado's ridiculous,
he's
man.
He's having such a good year.
He's got 3.3 WAR or something like that. He's unreal. Let's go to the outfield. This is going to be fun. I do want to clarify,
we're not going by position. We just picked the three best outfielders.
Three best outfielders.
Because if you went by position, you're robbing one right fielder, one deserving right fielder.
Oh, hold on. Give me 1 second. I forgot my AL shortstop pick.
Did we skip that entirely?
My bad. We skipped that.
I think we both said Tim Anderson, right?
I'm switching mine up.
You're going Xander?
Xander or Jeremy Peña. Jeremy Peña leads the everybody in WAR with 2.3. He's been ridiculous, first of all. As a rookie, he's been unreal. Jeremy Peña will make it. The right pick is probably Bogarts, but I'm giving Peña the love because I don't like.
It's probably not gonna be Anderson because he's out for three. He's out for at least.
Yeah,
3
unfortunately
weeks.
For him, he got hurt.
And Xander's still playing and
an elite level.
A big thing about Boston's top three really have been hitting their stride all year, and Trevor Story kind of getting hot, but Bogarts, Devers, Boston. And Martinez all having very good years.
Absolutely.
I think it's surprising you're going to see quite a few Boston All-Stars.
Oh, I agree. Well, at least with the hitters. Pitchers, none. Not a single one.
Tough.
Maybe Evaldi. Nah.
Evaldi's not making it.
Nasty Nate is not making it. Let's go to the outfield. Let's have fun with it. I mean, it's pretty chalk for the AL.
Let's start with the AL because it's pretty clearly
chalk.
Ward, Trout, Judge.
Yep, absolutely. Chalk.
Trout's going 0-for against the Yankees sunk his OPS below 1.0, but for a while, these were the only three AL outfielders with OPSs above 1.0. if
who
you
want, who else has joined them since?
If you want to have a fun time, like, kind of just go and take a look at Taylor Ward's stats.
He's ridiculous.
Because they're kind of ridiculous. We're talking 644 slug, the best OPS I think in the American League at 1.067.
Yeah,
like, 213 weighted runs created plus.
Yeah, highest weighted runs.
That's 113% better than league average.
2.63.
Ward's having a crazy year, and the crazy thing is that. You think about how good of a season Aaron Judge is having, and there's some disparity in the play appearances.
Right.
Ward's, a lot of Ward's numbers are better.
Yeah, exactly. It's just that his plate appearances aren't there, but he's in the MVP conversation.
And so,
sleek,
no, he's in the – and I think I put – in terms of the MVP conversation, you're putting Judge in the 21st home run certainly helps that.
Oh, absolutely.
He continues to bang. And
playing the best team in baseball.
I think it's like 50 or 60 plate appearances that Judge has more than Ward.
Yeah. And Judge, Trout,
but Ward's still very deserved.
Ward, Joe Ram. It can go many other ways. But, yeah, I mean, the AL outfield is chalk. Taylor Ward, great fantasy pickup. One of my best of the year. Probably my best. Let's go to the NL. NL's weird. I will say the NL is one clear guy. It's Mookie Betts. And two very weird open spots. Because Bryce Harper, I counted him as a DH.
Well, Harper is a DH. He's played 37 games as a DH.
So,
and spoiler, he's mine.
Yeah, he's
All-Star
my. It's clear. He's my AL DH. I mean,
I think I go Jock Peterson. Especially recently. He's been hitting a lot of home runs. He's got the OPS is up there again. There's not really a clear favorite. And then I'm looking at Mike Yastrzemski.
Yes, yep.
So I think those are my three. I'd be curious to see where you went.
I went with Yaz. Obviously, Mookie is undisputed. I did not go Jock Peterson.
I'm a little disappointed in the NL outfielders. It feels like the offensive production just
isn't there. It's very weak. Obviously, Harper switching positions for now has
killed
the production.
But you still think there'd be enough offensive production.
Especially with guys like Soto, Acuna in the NL. Come on, like, you got to at least have one of those. Soto is not one of mine. I feel like Soto's going to take it.
I guess you could throw in Acuna.
Yeah. No, I'm not throwing in either of them.
I mean...
I took Jeff McNeil.
Did you count him as outfielder?
I counted him as outfielder because at least when I looked at Fangraphs, he fit in second base and outfield. So I'm taking McNeil. Why not? McNeil's been phenomenal this year. Great. Phenomenal bounce back year. I'm going to give him the nod over like a guy like Nimmo, Chris Taylor. Who else could even be? Nobody really. It's Jeff McNeil.
I think if you look at Acuna's stats, he's legitimately in the conversation.
Yeah, but Acuna's
plate appearances are very low.
The plate appearances are low.
If he gets that up, he's in the conversation.
Oh, definitely. But since he's not there yet, I snubbed Acuna. We can skip DH because we NLDH.
Well,
at least.
Skip LDH.
Yeah, ALDH is fun.
We have a
fun one.
I'm going JD.
Okay, fair.
Pretty clearly.
I'm going Yordan Alvarez personally. I think Yordan's got the edge and power.
I mean, he just signed a big 6-year extension.
And
he
hit a nuke yesterday.
But
right after getting paid.
If I'm correct here, I'm pretty sure that JD leads ALDHs in most offensive categories.
Yeah, probably with a batting average. Slugging, Yordan has him. OBP and batting average, JD has him. Home runs, Yordan has 10.
Oh, wow.
Yordan has a higher weighted runs created plus. Yesterday put him over the edge. He has more WAR too, 1.9 to 1.7. ISO, isolated slugging or whatever, 3.311 versus 0.190. I mean, like, come on. To me, it's Yordan, and I think it's pretty clear.
The hitting for the All-Star team is more clear. I think the pitching's the fun conversation. Let's try and run through it quick because we're getting up against it.
Yeah, let's get to that.
I would say for the AL, I want Nestor to be
Nasty Nestor
the,
is my starter.
The starter. I think some sneaky guys that you could legitimately be talking about. McClanahan.
Shane McClanahan's
having a really good year. Martin Perez,
another third.
Leads the AL in ERA.
Yep.
Which I don't think you saw that coming. And then I think Logan Gilbert having a really good year.
Gilbert, I feel like he's going to make it, but he's not on my five. So who are your five? Because we have three already
in
tandem.
I thought I threw it in four there. My five is Manoah.
Manoah, okay. I snubbed Manoah because his FIP is very shaky and like he's due for regression. I put Kevin Gausman, who's leading the league in FIP. His ERA is like 2.51. He's been ridiculous, but he's going to get even better. He also leads all pitchers in WAR with 2.7. Tarik Skubal's my fifth starter. Skubal's been unreal
For Detroit.
For Detroit, he's been a phenomenal pitcher. Great to see Skubal break out, but let's go over to the NL. Starting pitchers before
it's
we wrap
tough.
Up with the relievers.
I'm going Musgrove, Burns, Lopez, mm-hmm. Alcantara. I snuck in Gonsolin.
Ooh, Gonsolin's a good pick. So we have four in common.
I think Miami's a lock to get two starters in the All-Star
absolutely. You snuck in Gonsolin. I fully respect that. I mean, Gonsolin's my fantasy team. He's a stud.
Not a bad pitcher. The innings are a little low, but he's gonna
and
get
the
up there.
K's are a little bit low, but he's six and what six?
1.5 ERA.
1.5 ERA. He's ridiculous. I put Zach Wheeler in. I put Zach Wheeler. His FIP indicates that he's been better than his ERA shows. He's been a little unlucky. I believe he leads the NL and FIP. He's been really good. 1.7 WAR, tied with Joe Musgrove, I believe, with the lead. Or maybe Musgrove overtook him. But let's end it off with relief pitchers, three each.
I'll go quick. AL. Holmes, FireEyes, and Romano.
JP just got hurt. I feel so bad for him. JP FireEyes.
I think he still deserves it. Hasn't allowed an earned run yet. Yeah. Clay Holmes, that's obvious. Second best reliever in baseball.
Clay Holmes and Romano are pretty obvious.
NL, I have Hader. Best reliever in baseball, yes. David Bednar, who we talked about a little bit earlier. We want the Yankees to trade for him. And then Joe Mantiply. I don't know if you know who this guy is. In 21 innings, a .042 ERA for Arizona.
Interesting.
So those are my guys.
I respect that. So I went different from you. Instead of, FireEyes? I put Michael King just because of his WAR and his leading all relievers in K's. I know he struggled recently, but I'm giving King the edge. And then, And now I went Hader, Taylor Rogers, and Edwin Diaz.
Rogers' ERA just went. I think he blew a save, and his ERA went sky high.
All right, so maybe we change Rogers, but we'll check in with that later. And then while we have a little bit of time, let's make a quick two bench spots for the AL and NL.
So AL, I think you're going to you got to sneak Devers in there.
Devers, yep. I think it's chalk for the AL.
So because I had JD, I'm sneaking in Yordan, one of the DHs.
I'm going Devers and JD.
NL, you have to. Alonso has to be a DH, and I think Arenado has to be an all-star.
Oh, we had it in line. Perfect. I mean, we had the same exact bench, and, you know, that was a fun little segment. It's been a great show, but that's going to do it for our show today. A special thank you to Colin Loughran and our interview, Mark Berman, for joining the show. If you missed any of today's show or any of our interviews, don't worry. They'll be available on WFUVsports.org and our YouTube page, WFUV Sports. Sports director of WFUV is Bobby Chaffardini. Our video producer today was Julian Moss, and our radio producer was Ralph Barbieri. Listen, the show's coming to the close, but you can catch One-on-One every Saturday afternoon on YouTube or on 90.7 FM every Saturday night from 11 p.m. to 2 a.m. Until next time, from Lou Orlando and Miles Grossman, I'm Tyler Hu, signing off and saying so long for the Bronx. One-on-One is a production of WFUV Sports.